Dallas Cowboys on three. Make it loud. One, two, three.
Dallas Cowboys.
Snap back to Prescott. He's going deep. Down the right side. Over the shoulder for Bryant. Perfect. All the way down and around the 25-yard line of the Eagles.
Get the right kind of guys here. High standards. Work your ass off every day. High accountability. Okay? And then it shows up on Sunday.
Out of the gun, back to Dak. They've taken another shot in the end zone. It does! Left side of the end zone. Touchdown, Dez Bryant. Looking, let out. Starts up the middle. Now he pulls it back. Now he peels around left. Now he throws it in the end zone. Jason Witten. Touchdown. Cowboys win.
You love them or you hate them, but you will tune in and turn in to see what people are saying about them. That's why they call America's team.
How about this, Cowboys? Yeah!
What's going on, everybody?
What's up, what's up?
How about them Cowboys?
How about them?
You excited today?
Oh, I am excited.
Oh, I know.
I am super excited.
Hey, there you go again. I mean, you're always doing that,
ain't
man.
Ain't nobody worried about you.
Okay.
I got to talk, too. Okay. I'm super excited. I'm also JK.
And I'm Big Game James.
It's cool.
Check us out today. Hey, we appreciate you last week. We had our Q&A last week. It was a success. Appreciate all you Cowboys tuning in. I hope you're tuning in today. It's more Q&A. We're going to talk about some good topics today. We already know what happened. Tony Romo leaving the game kind of hurt my feelings. We're going to talk about Romo. We got some good discussions today.
He looked kind of goofy in that blazer.
Didn't he?
He looked awkward.
I hope he doesn't look awkward in that booth.
No. That's the only Romo bashing we'll do for today. Okay. It's going to be nothing but respect for that, man. Maybe
nothing
even some praising.
Today. Nothing but
big
respect.
Big respect for him for what he did. But.
So we're going to talk about Romo, but like we said before, we're going to give nothing but Romo respect today. So make sure whenever you if you chime in today and we're talking about Romo, let's give him his love. Hey, we can disagree, but like I said, we got to show our appreciation for what he did for the organization. I mean, like I said, you come out of Eastern Illinois, undrafted, 2003. I remember when he came on the roster, and I remember actually looking at the roster like, who is this Tony Romo dude? Like, I kept wondering, like, why do they keep him on the roster every year? He must be doing something. And I think it was when the third year when we had Bledsoe, and that it was that fourth preseason game where the games kind of didn't matter to everybody, and he threw for like 400 yards in that preseason game.
Yep.
And I was like, guess what? I think we got this guy. And as you saw, Bledsoe comes out, Romo comes in and has a tremendous run. Although he didn't get us to a Super Bowl, which that hurts my heart. I feel like he deserved it. But
man, me and G were watching the botched snap in the Seahawks game. Man, that was – there were so many things that could have gone the other way.
Man.
Who was it? Vanderjack got a block on whoever was coming. He chipped him a little bit.
Right.
If he would have got just a better piece of him, Romo probably scores. We're talking differently about this. I mean, that's maybe three playoff wins. But, man, it's so close. There's that many little things in his career that changed him from possibly being a, you know, Super Bowl champion.
And that's crazy how, like, one play, almost one play, like, people that don't like him or want to hate on him define him through that. Mm-hmm. But like you said, if he would have gotten that end zone on that botch play, who knows what could have happened the next 10 years with us.
Because then you don't have that monkey on your back.
Exactly, because that's what you held to.
Yeah,
exactly.
I mean, that was if he can get the ball down, Vanderjack probably makes the kick, we win. If he gets the end zone, we win.
Exactly.
Get the block. Oh, man, there's so many things.
And then Parcells probably never leaves.
Yeah, a whole different story, and then that would lead into something we'd probably talk about later.
Yeah, you know we're going to talk
about
it. Cowboy fans, we got
teaser,
something
we got
for you to talk about later.
We'll bring that up, man. Yeah. That's that one hurts too. But
let me forget. Don't forget to check us out on our website, silverandbluenation.com.
Got
to
go there.
You can also check us out
that
on Twitter.
Got a sweet layout.
SB Nation 17.
SB Nation 17 on the Twitter box.
See that, G? And don't let me forget, our producer, G, he's the guy, the man of the hour who puts all this together.
Give him a little what's up, G.
What's up, G?
See you over there.
Appreciate you guys. I'm just sitting over here
cooking.
On the audio board.
Cooking it up. Dr. Drake
making
cooking
sure
it up.
Everybody has a good show.
Yeah, he's
thanks for tuning in.
He's cooking it up.
You can see what he's got cooking it up. You know, he's got it on the YouTube at the Silver and Blue Nation. Subscribe to the channel so you can get those updates and see the weekly updates. Me and Big Game James stand in front of green screen looking goofy.
Let me tell them the secrets. Don't tell them the secrets.
Y'all don't know.
So talk to me, G. Talk to me, G. Right now, throw me a question out, G.
We're talking a little Tony Romo.
Yeah, we're talking a little Tony Romo.
All right,
Romo.
Well, we know Tony Romo just retired a couple days ago. He's joining CBS.
Right.
So so the question has to be asked, is he going to play in the NFL again?
I hope not.
I hope not. My opinion is I don't think he will come out. If he does come back into the game, it's only going to be with the Cowboys. I think him and Jerry Jones got that kind of unspoken code now that, look, if you're going to go to the booth, if you come back with us. I don't think he's going to disrespect and go to another team. I think that's why he ultimately left the game.
Right.
Because he wasn't going to play for somebody else. We didn't want to see him with anybody else. But I don't see him actually coming back into the NFL unless something major happens to Dak as far as the injury goes. And, you know, that's why he left the door open with the CBS that I can come back at any time.
And that's why I'm saying I hope not. I hope he doesn't, because that means something unfortunate has happened.
Exactly. And we don't want that. We don't want to see nothing happen to Dak. So I don't think he's going to come back and play. I really don't want to see him come back and play, not because I didn't miss him, is because the injuries. You know, I mean, he had major injuries, back surgery, shoulder, and as if you think about it, he had two shoulder injuries. Obviously, it wasn't to his throwing shoulder, but you got to think about it. If somebody else lands on that shoulder like that again, you just have to fear like something's going to happen. So I just don't want to see it happen from him.
Yeah, and that's, you know, the back injuries are tough to come back from. We kind of touched on that. Like, you know, I think that's part of the reason why he didn't go play with the Texans or the Broncos. You know, maybe he doesn't want to be injured. Maybe he wants to be able to walk. Maybe he's seen what Earl Campbell looks like.
Right.
When he, you know, I saw him up, Earl Campbell up at the Hall of Fame game last year, and he's riding around in a golf cart.
Because he can't walk.
He can't walk.
Exactly.
So I think maybe Romo had that little bit of an idea that he wants to continue to be able to walk.
And that's
we were talking about the G, you know, he's actually a really, really good golfer, almost qualified for the U.S. Open a couple of times. So maybe he can get in that booth,
you need
have
that
some
back
time
for,
to golf.
Don't you
know,
need that back for golf?
You want it. I mean, that's you don't want to be hurt all the time. So maybe he's looking at his future a little bit, you know, with the kids and everything he's got going on. And maybe he made a good decision for him. And, you know, that's I don't ever question his passion for the game. I think he's just making the right decision. It leaves him the opportunity to go do something else, broadcast. And if the opportunity arises where something happens and he needs to come back, he can come back.
Exactly.
And we're good to go.
And you're so long-winded.
All man, right, well, it ain't nothing like you. I'm just trying to be like you. One day when I grow up, be like Big Game.
Okay.
Some other chatter that was going on Facebook this week was people were asking, is he a Hall of Famer? So what do you guys think about that?
I think he has Hall of Fame numbers. I mean, throwing over like 34,000 yards, over 200 yards, 200 touchdowns, I think like 224 touchdowns. Top five all-time QB rating, all-time.
Yep.
I mean, leader in fourth quarter drives overall since what? He came in the actually started at 2006
against
like 32.
Impressive competition.
Very impressive competition. I think those are Hall of Fame numbers, but I got to give you the but. He didn't win. I mean, he didn't win with us, and that's what quarterbacks are measured by. I mean, if you look at Phillip Rivers, he hasn't won. I mean, if you look at these great quarterbacks, the only quarterback, if you look at like Dan Marino, Dan Marino doesn't have a Super Bowl, but he went to a Super Bowl.
He won 8 playoff games.
And that's the key.
That's 4 times as many as Romo.
Exactly.
And that's why he gets a pass.
And if you don't win in the playoffs, you can win in the regular season, but even think about it. Even Peyton Manning, what were they saying about him? Couldn't win the big one. Greatest regular season quarterback, but can't win the big one.
Yep.
They were holding that over him. John Elway, they were holding over his head. You've been to going to these Super Bowls, but you ain't winning, so they're going to hold that over your head.
And
so,
it's even worse when you're just going to wild card round.
And you're losing.
And you're losing.
And that's, if you look at his playoff record, it's not great. And he never got to an NFC championship. He never got to a Super Bowl. And I feel like that is going to keep him out of the Hall of Fame. So, no, he does not
he's
go
going
to
up
Hall of
in
Fame
that,
in my
going
eyes.
Up in that ring of honor. And I agree with you. I don't think he's going to go Hall of Fame unless, you know, maybe potentially as a broadcaster he could go in. But, no, I think he's going up in the ring of honor. I think he's a solid Cowboys player in history and
all right,
not
well.
Hall of Fame.
Speaking of history, normally the Cowboys put a hold on, you know, certain jersey numbers.
Uh-huh.
Emmitt Smith's 22, Aikman's 8. You know, we'll probably never see anybody wear those numbers again.
Right.
So what about Romo's number 9? Do you think that should be held in the same regard?
I do. I think, you know, we were talking a little bit earlier. There's 4 quarterbacks, although they did, I think you said Drew Bledsoe wore Danny White's number.
Yep.
But I feel like if you're a quarterback and you come into Dallas Cowboys, there's certain numbers that you cannot get. They may not be retired, but there's certain numbers that you cannot get as a Dallas Cowboy. And you cannot get number 12 for Roger Staubach. Number
unless
8,
you're Tom Brady.
You cannot get Troy Aikman. And I feel like Romo has proven himself to be worthy of when you come in, you can't take number 9, not sit in the bench. Unless you're like one of those all-time greats that get traded to us,
right.
We could give you the number, but you're not getting Romo, you're not getting Aikman, and you're not getting Staubach in my eyes. Danny White, he's up in the air, but people forget, Danny White took us to 3 NFC championships. He just never got over the hump.
He's basically the first version of Romo.
Pretty much.
Right. So
solid.
Moving on from that, more chatter this week was, I don't know if you guys saw what Skip Bayless was saying on his Fox Sports 1 show about he was questioning Romo's passion to win a Super Bowl. What do you guys think?
I totally disagree with that. Now, I will say, Romo had a game, if you remember, that Philadelphia game where we got blown out, like lost 38-6, and Romo said, like, if this is the worst thing that happens to me in this victory, then I lived a pretty good life. I'm not going to lie. As a Cowboys fan, I was very upset with him that he said that, because I'm like, do you understand who you play for? You play for the Dallas Cowboys. You cannot say things like that. We're too passionate. So I felt I was – that's when I questioned. But then right after that, I think he understood the magnitude of what he said and was like, you know what, I should never say that. And when you've seen him play, the dude played through punctured ribs. I mean, if he didn't have the – anytime he had an injury that he could come back, he came back and played. So I definitely feel like he had the passion for the Super Bowl, but we just never had the teams.
Well, looking on the other side of the coin, you know – Go ahead.
No, that's on you, Jason.
We're good. All right, let's move on then. I was going to say, I
never questioned his passion to win a Super Bowl, ever. I never questioned it. He was an NFL player. That's the goal. That's what you go out there to do. You're not going out there just to play football. I mean, at the end of the day, it's what you're doing. But, no, I think
about
I...
About the fact that he could play with Denver or Houston, teams that could possibly win a Super Bowl, and he's choosing to walk away instead.
I look at that as his passion is to win the Super Bowl with the Dallas Cowboys. Mm-hmm. And I respect that even more, too, because, you know, this is Cowboys Nation. This is Silver Blue Nation.
Right.
He was you know, silver and blue through and through. That's what you wanted out of your quarterback, and that's –
And how often does a job like that come around?
I mean, right.
Jim's been there since I was a child.
You're getting the number one spot.
So,
and Chris
right away.
Didn't like that.
No, he sure did. Right.
Yeah, and like I said before, Chris Sims did not like that his dad got moved out the booth.
Nope.
But I'm going to leave that one alone.
Boo the Giants anyway.
Exactly. What's up, G? Talk to me.
So we love Romo. We're going to move on from that, though. I mean, that's a couple days ago, so we don't want to harp too much on the Romo situation.
What up, Hawaii?
What up, Hawaii? Connecticut.
Connecticut in here, too.
Let's talk about the offense a little bit.
Okay.
Who's a player you think's really going to take that next step this season?
Good.
I mean, I know we talked about off air and everybody's like, he's already been a breakout player even when he was younger, but I'm talking Dez Bryant. Yeah. I think he needs to be when we're talking about breakout players, the reason why I'm saying that is because he was a top five receiver not too long ago, maybe about 3 years ago. He had the injury in 2015, knocked him down a little bit, and then he came back with only 52 receptions this year. Had, I think, maybe 800 yards receiving, but had about 8 touchdowns. I think that
he said snuck into a Pro Bowl too.
He snuck into a Pro Bowl. Somebody sat out, but to me, he's going to be a breakout player for us again because he's got another year with Dak. If you could see at the end of the year, they were basically bonding together. They were finally getting that back shoulder throw. Romo and Dez were so good with that back shoulder throw. So now you start to see Dak and Dez getting that together. If you see Dak and Dez getting that connection, our offense
scary,
is going to be ridiculous.
He's had that back shoulder throw since he's come in the preseason last year. You could tell that back shoulder throw he's comfortable with.
Right.
So like you said, when he gets there with Dez, that's going to be deadly. Because that's what Dez is good at. He's such a big body. Let him do it.
Let me just chime in here for a quick second.
Okay.
We appreciate all the comments and questions. We're going to get to the Q&A in just a few. So just hang in there.
Yes, sir, fans. We hear you. We love
appreciate
you.
Appreciate everybody. Just go ahead and put in the comments where you're at. Shout you out.
What's up, Miss Teresa in Peoria, Illinois?
What's up, Miss Teresa? Franco, Olivero, Davis, Nagata. Franco, I love all y'all. What's up? How about them Cowboys?
How about?
Who's your breakout player?
My breakout player, like I said earlier, I want it to be Bryce Butler, but at the same time, I kind of don't because that means he's playing too much.
Okay.
But I would like it to be Cole Beasley. I want to see him get that, you know, 1,200 yard receiving and just explode onto the scene. So everybody knows that like he's our Wes Welker, he's our Julian Edelman, he's our slot receiver. This is the sauce balls. That's what you're getting. That's what I want to see. And if not him, you know, let's see Rico Gathers. I want to see him break out and play.
Yeah, we've been talking about Rico Gathers off the air for a while. If we can get Swain back from injury, he was a big key for us, especially with blocking. Swain was a sneaky receiver, but whenever we went to that 11 personnel or 10 personnel where we got both two tight ends, him and Witten were a beast. If you throw him in with the blocking when we're running with Zeke and then you throw Gathers in on those third down plays and start getting him some box out plays because he's a basketball player, I'm telling you, with that size, 6'7", 275 280 pounds.
And you're running action on third down with Zeke.
What? That's ridiculous.
And, I mean, and Dak's going to be mobile to roll out either side.
And drop it right to him. Uh-oh. And you don't have to give him any hard passes. You can do it where you're just dropping it right to him. Uh-oh. And he's making plays. So I like that. What about you, G? Who you think is going to break out for them Cowboys?
I mean, it's probably going to be Lael Collins. I mean,
yes, sir.
I got to agree with JK.
I like you.
You know, he didn't really get to play last year. He had a really solid rookie year.
Uh-huh.
I would like to see him switch out the right tackle. Just give him a shot because that's what he did in college.
I just want
to
see Zeke running behind him because Lael Collins will be down the field 5 yards in front of him the whole time.
If he stays healthy, I don't see any reason why he won't be a Pro Bowler to go with the rest of them.
Yep.
And you just need the right tackle. We're set.
I agree. I'd like to see him slide out to the right tackle spot. I mean, we got Bell and
he's
we got
a freaking
Cooper,
bulldozer.
Both of those guys. And we still and people still forget. I know Chaz Green has been injured his whole time that he's been there, but he's proven that he's been good when he's been healthy.
Yep.
So if you have those three in the fold, still maybe get another offensive lineman off the free agency because I wouldn't say maybe draft him maybe until the later rounds.
Somebody
really
will be
need to be defense, but some will get an offensive lineman because we got good offensive line coaches, and they're going to coach them up. And when you have a standard like you have with our offensive line, with Frederick, with Martin, with Smith, it makes those other guys step up because they don't want to be the weak link on the line.
Right, and they're just going to make you look better naturally too because they are so good.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to look that much better.
Exactly.
It's going to have a good positive effect on your career. So come play with the Cowboys.
Not all day, not all day. Talk to me, G.
Wellsville, Ohio.
Wellsville.
Colin Moore is the backup quarterback right now. I don't think Jamil Showers is the guy. Colin Kaepernick's still out there. Do you think there's a possibility he comes to the Cowboys this year? And if not, if he doesn't go to any team, why isn't he getting more looks right now?
Well, with the Colin Kaepernick thing, I know a lot of people, it's almost kind of don't want to talk about it because I have my personal view about it. And everybody's, you know, because of taking the knee, a lot of people took that personal.
Mm-hmm.
And my personal opinion, I think he's getting blackballed because of it. The NFL saying he's not. I disagree because you have so many other people. Geno Smith is getting a backup job. Chase Daniel, who never throws a pass, are getting backup job signing.
Tyrod Taylor, big money.
Uh-huh. And Kaepernick, he didn't have a – people say that he threw a lot of touchdowns in garbage time, but it's still 16 touchdowns. It's four picks. It's still 2,200 yards. It's still, you know, around 59 completion percentage. That is good. And it's not like he's a quarterback that hasn't proven he can take you somewhere and win. He's proven when he was at San Francisco. I wouldn't mind him as a backup. You're kind of shady on Kellen Moore. I kind of would like to have somebody else. I wish we would have got McCowan because I know he's 37, but I like him as a leadership role. I like Kellen Moore more as of a third-string guy. But I would bring Kaepernick in, but I think he's getting blackballed for what he did.
I don't want Kellen Moore on the team at all. I don't get the point of him even being there just because he knows the offense, but like, I never had any faith in him.
You keep on, sorry if you happen to be watching Kellen Moore, but you're a little guy.
Yeah, and maybe I hate myself.
Okay. You hate yourself.
But I would like Kaepernick. Hey, I mean, I think he's getting blackballed. Jerry Jones said he wouldn't bring somebody along, you know, kneel, and he wouldn't stand for that. So bring him in. If he kneels, get rid of him. He'd be a good backup quarterback if we need him.
I just want to put this out there. Who does JK look like? Somebody put a comment.
We already know what JK looks like.
He gets it all the time.
All the time.
What?
When I first look at him, I think
he's
of the same person.
Wait.
Young Richard Gere.
Richard Gere.
Staying on the offensive side of the ball.
Okay.
Woodbridge, Virginia, Charles Tapper.
We know we got Zeke.
Yes.
We know he's the workhorse. You know, he's the guy going forward, franchise running back.
Run easy. So
what's the backup going to look like this year? We got Darren McFadden and Alfred Morris. Is it going to stay like that?
I personally, I seen somebody post about, you know, who is Alfred Morris the guy? Now, we had talked about earlier last year was, you know, Morris going to be the guy. I thought it was a good pickup for him to be a backup. But when I saw him play, I see why Washington got rid of him. Just my personal opinion, he doesn't have the explosion. He can hit the hole, but he can't hit the hole hard because he lacks the explosion. I think that's the reason why the Redskins got rid of him because, number one, he was never a fast back. When he came out of Florida in Atlantic, I believe, he was a 4'6", 4'6", 5".
He was never
a
home run hitter.
And after 4 years of tread on your tires, remember, he had 1,600 yards himself his rookie year.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got tread on the tires.
I'll take him as a third-string running back, though.
But I like McFadden.
Yes.
Me personally, I like them re-signing McFadden. McFadden is great in a backup role. People say the injuries. Well, he came with us, and he played a whole year with us, was the fourth leading rusher in the NFL with our offense. offense. And if you saw when he came back from injury, he had that burst. So when you have Zeke and McFadden, you can put them both in the backfield because McFadden can catch the ball at the backfield.
And he looked quick when he came in the
game
last year.
He looked real quick
at the end
strong.
Of the season. He came in. It was a difference.
It was a difference.
The defense was getting tired. You could tell he looked quicker than everybody else on the field at that time.
And honestly, don't you think that if we're wearing our defense down with Zeke and then you come in with a McFadden and they're tired and McFadden can break it.
And he's a big, strong guy. He's going to run upright and hit you in the shoulders and mouth. And I'll tell you one thing on the backup running back situation. I'm kind of disappointed that we couldn't keep Darius Jackson.
Man.
And we held on, and my feeling is we held on to Lance Dunbar too long and missed out on Darius Jackson. And if Darius Jackson gets some playing time up in Cleveland, you guys might see that. I think he's going to be a very good running back, and he would have been a sweet backup running back compliment to Zeke for a few years if we could have kept him around.
I totally agree. We went too long with the Dunbar experiment. We kept on waiting for him to break out. But if you're going to break out, give him the ball. They weren't giving him the ball, and he was always injured. He wasn't a big guy anyway. And every time it looked like he was about to do something, he gets hurt. You can't keep relying on that every single year. The same way with what I'm talking about with Lucky Whitehead.
Yep.
You, after so many years, it's like you are what you are, and that's what he is. So, like you said, it hurt my soul when we lost Jackson because I'm like, why are we keeping Dunbar? And look where Dunbar's at. He's not
we
even
held on
with
to
our
Dunbar.
Team this year.
We held on to him 1 year too long. I like Dunbar too, but 1 year too long with him, and now we missed Jackson because of that. And I don't think Jackson's going to be like, you know, Hall of Famer that we missed out on, but he was going to be a good, solid running back to
he's
be
a good
compliment.
Of pace.
And he's very similar to Zeke's running style. Maybe that's why they thought
he was a
little more
back.
Disposable. Yeah, I mean, he's almost same size, his stats were almost the exact same as Zeke's coming out. If you look at his combine stats and you tried to pick which one just blindly looking at him, you probably wouldn't be able to tell the difference. Honestly, you wouldn't be able to tell. The only thing you'd be able to tell is that Eastern Michigan versus Ohio State for the college.
And there's a big difference with that.
Yes.
Talk to me, Jake.
Let's switch gears a little bit here. James, you and I were talking a little bit about this off the air. You were saying that Jason Garrett might be the coach equivalent to Tony Romo as a player as far as not being able to win the big one. So that led to a question, and it was a hot topic on Facebook this week. Who's the best head coach in Dallas Cowboys history? And you can chime in on the Jason Garrett thing, too.
All right. Well, for me, like me and you were talking about, G, to me, Jason Garrett is becoming the Tony Romo of coaches right now because he's been there, 6 years now? I mean, we have two NFC East titles. We have three 8-8 seasons, and we have the 4-12, which I understand about the injuries. Now, the thing I love about Garrett is because he does get the team to play hard. They respect him. I like that. But at the end of the day, for you to take that next level, you have to win these big games. You can win them in the regular season, but at the end of the day, we're playing for the playoffs and Super Bowls, and we need championships. And so, to me, he has to prove that he's going to take us to the next level. If we have another good year and he doesn't produce, now in my heart I'm thinking maybe we need to look for somebody else. Because at the end of the day, we have the team. You cannot waste years of your football life. You can't not play forever. Just because we talked about it before, just because you were injury-free last year doesn't mean you'll be injury-free this year. Garrett has to do it, or he will be labeled as one of the Tony Romos of the football coaching world.
Speaking of long-winded.
Yeah,
jeez.
Appreciate those questions coming in. Just hang in there. We're going to get to those here.
Yes,
shortly.
We will. We see y'all, folks. We're going to get back
right
to
now.
You.
We're just running down some of the hot topics for the week, and then we'll jump right into some Q&A.
I agree with the Garrett thing though. He needs to win, dude. If we get there again and lose in the playoffs again, it's kind of looking like maybe it's the coaching position more so than the players because
it's not looking, it is.
He's the one that's putting us in this position.
Yes.
Which he's putting us in the position to win, but then he's not succeeding. So something's going to have to change. I don't think they're getting rid of quarterback, running back, anything too soon. So it's probably going to be his head that rolls.
I mean, and I hope Jerry Jones doesn't keep trying to hold on to him like it's his son, like he kind of did with Romo.
Mm-hmm.
You got to look at, we have to get the coaches that are going to make the team produce. I like you still getting Linehan and Rob Marinelli, but we have been talking about before, the guy who we really wanted, Sean Payton. Had him in the fold with Bill Parcells. I don't know if people talk about that, but we had Sean Payton, and he was going to be the successor to Parcells. But to me, I don't know if Jerry Jones ran him out the building or, you know, Sean Payton was so headstrong because Sean Payton is a headstrong coach.
But
guess what? He left. He got a Super Bowl. That's what I look at.
Jerry Jones ran off every good coach that's come through. Imagine, you know, we could have had Landry for a couple more years. That probably would have been a good little start, maybe avoid –
No.
I like the way all that started.
You were young. I was there.
I like the way all that started.
I don't like how we got rid of Landry, but I felt like it was time, and it was a time for a new regime.
Okay, and it worked out great, so that's why I'm okay with it. But then you run off Jimmy Johnson. That ruins potentially winning four Super Bowls in a row.
Don't bring
it. And then, like you said, you know, we miss out on Sean Payton right after we run off Bill Parcells. Look what Wade Phillips did when he left. He even was successful for a little while. Not so much anymore, but
at the end of the day, it comes down to coaching. You can have the players. You can have great players. We've seen teams that have great players, but it's the coaching. The coach has to get those guys in those critical situations to get over the hump. And to me, this is your year, Garrett. You had 13-3. You had 12-4. If you come back and win the division or like a 12-4 again, you must win. So we have to nail in the draft. Hopefully we will, but it's now or never to me for Garrett.
I'm needing a deep playoff run. Obviously, I know where I want it to end, but there needs to be a couple of playoff games. One, you need to string something together to probably keep your job at this point.
Exactly.
I think you make it to the wild card round and lose or something like that again. I don't know if he's coming back next year.
No, not if you lose. If you lose next year in the first round of like a wild card or something like that, to me, Jason Garrett has to go. That's just my personal opinion about it.
Yep. Deep playoff run, two games at least.
All right, let's jump into a little bit of Q&A. Let's go ahead and get started on some of that. We'll jump back into some of the other topics.
All right.
As we go, because we got questions and comments just lining up. Let's go ahead and get started on those. We appreciate all of them. Keep them coming.
What up, everybody?
Cowboys
I like seeing
fans.
All those little emojis popping up on the screen, too. Let's keep doing that. That looks cool on the screen.
All those likes.
Let's go ahead and jump into some Q&A if you guys want to look at it. Back at a couple questions there.
Okay, well, I've been seeing a lot of people been talking defense, and I've been screaming defense, too. I mean, that's our Achilles heel right now is our defense.
Yep.
To me, and I've been seeing a few questions. Flores, Beck, I'm listening to you with Irvin and Lawrence. First, let me answer the defensive back situation. Shout out to my guy Flores, Beck, Pesos, Peel. We all about to talk about it. First of all, with our cornerback position, we got the steal with Anthony Brown. I like his aggressiveness, not just as a corner that can cover. I like the way he tackles. He attacks the defense. He doesn't sit back. He doesn't luck. He doesn't want to tackle. I like him and Skandrick. Skandrick has to come back fully healthy.
Stay healthy.
And I like picking up Nolan Carroll for the simple fact that you don't like Carroll, but I like him because he's got good size. I'm not saying he's an all-world corner. I'm saying
he's a body,
he gives
and that's
us
what
stability.
We need right now.
If you're looking at Brandon Carr and Morris Claiborne, to me, he's an equivalent to that.
I think he's in between the two. He's going to give you a little bit more than Claiborne because he's going to be on the field.
Right.
Carr was always on the field.
Right.
He was somewhat productive as much as we hated on him. He was there. He got burned a lot, too, but I think we've seen what can happen to Nolan Carroll firsthand.
He can't get burst. So that's
look at the receivers in our division right now. So
exactly.
That's what I'm saying. Like Nolan Carroll is not going to be the best option.
He's not going to be the best option. I'm not saying that. But if, like I said, he's going to be on the field, he is feisty, he is aggressive. We know we have to hit the cornerback in the draft. We know we have to look at that.
Defensive
people have been talking
corner.
About people have been talking. Yes, I agree. Carroll
is
a stopgap.
Right, yeah.
They've been talking about Richard Sherman. I've already said it before. If we have the 28th pick and the Seattle Seahawks call the Dallas Cowboys and say, give us your 28th pick, you have a Richard Sherman. Bye. Richard Sherman is with us. That's my opinion because Sherman, even though people saying he is in decline because he's 28 years old, about to be 29, okay, but he's still an all-world corner. He doesn't play his game on physicality. He's physical at the line, but his size, he was never a fast guy. He's 6'3", 212 pounds, but he has an attitude. And what the Cowboys need is an attitude. We need attitude on defense. We need attitude when we're rushing a passer. We need attitude as a linebacker. That's what we need.
He's amped up.
I mean, he's going to get our team.
He's nasty.
The same way you have the offensive line that make those offensive linemen step up, he's the same type of guy will make a Brown step up, a Skandrick.
You better play up to his level or else he's going
to
let you know. He's going
to
let you know.
Exactly. And, I don't think we're going to – I feel you, Clay. I don't think we're going to get Sherman. But if it's offered and I say we take it, because why wait for an unproven player in the draft when you got a proven player and you can squeeze out 3 or 4 years out of him? Because right now the time is now. We ain't got time to keep waiting 3 or 4 years to wait to see if we're going to get a Super Bowl. The time is now.
Yep.
So we have the players to get now. So if we, just like when Charles Haley came over to Dallas from San Francisco, Jimmy Johnson knew the time is now to get Super Bowls. So we got to make that blockbuster trade. Even with Herschel Walker, Deion Sanders, you got to get those difference makers. And until you get a difference maker, you're not going to that next level. I don't care what nobody says.
Nope. So, Doug, what are we doing now that Doug Free retired? Going to get a lot less penalties.
Exactly. A lot less holding calls, dumb penalties. I know Free was a rock with us, but guess what? He had a lot of penalties, untimely. Every time we get a 15-yard gain, holding, number 68, Doug Free. I mean, every time, dude. Like,
ask Zeke how he feels about that.
I mean, he's the one that had – remember that long run he had against Minnesota and he almost scored a touchdown? Holding, Doug Free. I want to see Leo Collins switch out to that right tackle. Let's prep him for that sliding Cooper, sliding Bell at the guard spot, and let's roll with that. Because Collins, I think, will be, like you said, he can break out.
His game's going to be elevated by those guys surrounding him. He's going to be a bulldozer.
Exactly.
Because, like I said, my favorite highlights are watching him 10, 15, 20 yards downfield in front of running backs, and I think we're going to see that a lot with Zeke.
Exactly.
It's going to be great.
So, you know, at the end of the day, I love having rookies, but we need those veterans that are actually going to make a difference right now. We need those guys. We don't have time. Like, people keep us saying we're young. You're not young and forever in the NFL.
Nope.
Those are NFL years are like dog years. 1 year in the NFL is like 5 years. So you can't sit there and keep on thinking, oh, next year, because you might not be injury free. So the time is now. Yep. Get the players now so we can make things happen.
The window opened up. Like I said, last year, I think we saw that window open up completely. And now it's time to step through it, jump through that window, whatever you got to do. But it's going to close quickly.
Exactly.
And like I said, we've got these contracts worked out to where we have a small
window.
Now is the time. Is the time.
Shout out to Ron Beck. What's
it
up, big dog? I gave you a little shout out. It's
Ron
Beck. A beautiful thing.
What's up, man?
Now, if we don't get everybody's questions at one time, we're trying. I'll jump on the Ron Leary thing. Who we thought was our biggest loss to me was Leary. Also, I like how we got Stephen Paya in there, but Terrell McClain was a loss on the defensive side. He had four sacks, but he was aggressive. He played good run-stopping defense.
He's one of them big uglies that we needed down there.
And I liked him, but I agree. Leary was a big loss, but we got other guys I feel that can slide in on the offensive line. So I don't think Leary is going to be a huge loss for us, but I think that because we know how to draft the offensive linemen and the guys that we have are just going to make other guys step up. And guys want to come to us and play now because they're like, hey, if you're an offensive lineman, you want to come to the Cowboys because now we set a standard.
Did we touch on Tavares' question about Jalen Smith?
Jalen
Smith.
We
did, but like thoughts on him playing this year?
Oh,
my
please,
thoughts are
please.
Yes, I cannot wait to
Jalen
see that
Smith
man.
Play.
I want to see that swipe. I want to see it a lot because he is going to be a freak. I'm ready.
I mean, watching his highlights and even watching him at Notre Dame, Jalen Smith was a monster.
I think he's going to get a lot more sacks than people think.
I think he will too. But once again, if you have a Jalen Smith and he's fully healthy and you have somebody coming off that edge, if David Irvin steps up, I'm not so secure. I heard a question. I'm not on DeMarcus Lawrence. I think he's just an average player. He's not a player that's going to get 10 sacks a year for us. I'm throwing that out the door. I'm just not believing that anymore about him. He's a good run stopper. He maybe get you 5-6 sacks, maybe. But he's not a guy that's coming after the quarterback. Irvin's got to show me this year. I've seen flashes, but you got to be consistent. He only started 2 games in his 2-year career with us. He's got to start more games, and he's got to be productive. That's why I said we got to get somebody coming off that edge. If you can put a Jalen Smith on the outside of somebody who can rush that passer, what? That's going to be crazy.
Shout out Ron Beck. Do it again.
Hey,
what's up,
there,
Ron Beck?
Put in there where you're at. I want to see where you're from, Ron
Beck. Where you from, Ron Beck?
Show us where you're at, Ron Beck. But like I told you about Irvin, I think he could break out. He has the 6'7", 280-pound size, and he had great games. But to me, it's all about consistency. If you're not consistent on the line with Ron Marinelli, he's not going to play you.
Right.
Remember, he sat down our free agent pickup from Oakland, Benson Mayoa. He came over us. He was starting. He sat down like 3 games. He came back, ended up being our sack leader. So he will sit you if you're not producing. But we have to get the players to produce on that field.
Yep.
Point blank.
We do. Shout out to McGregor, Texas. Ron Beck.
Man. I'm gonna have to get
How
you
about
out
them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys? Oh, now, with the Randy Gregory thing.
Hello, Mr. Akers.
I can't give you the shout out for that. Right
I'll say his name, but y'all can handle him.
Right.
We'll handle Mr. Leon's question about Mr. Gregory.
Yeah. But as far as Randy Gregory goes, this is what I feel about Randy Gregory. Reason why everybody's upset with him and mad at him because of the situation, him not playing. Why are you upset and you're mad at him? Because he's so good, and you know he's going to be so good. To me, he was that player to get us to that next level. That's why everybody's so frustrated with him, because he was that player to me. Randy Gregory is that player. It's just the fact that he can't stay out of trouble. If he wasn't that player, Jerry Jones would have got rid of him. He's not getting rid of him because he's only going to be like 24 years old, even after sitting out 2 years. And why? You can still take a chance, draft real good, and then if he does come back, that's an added bonus.
I said, just take that number 94 off of him and see what happens.
I agree, Gonzalez. He is so immature.
Real quick, if anybody wants a How About Them Cowboys, put it in the comments. I'll play it for you, the clip. How About Them Cowboys?
How About Them Cowboys?
I saw Biloxi, Mississippi.
Biloxi, Mississippi. That's Mississippi. Home of Brett Favre. Okay. All right. Yeah, I hear you, Gonzalez. Wasted potential. Like I said, it hurts my heart every time. Because I seen him the last two games of the year, and you could just see it. You could just see it when you've seen Gregory play, like, oh, my gosh, why did he mess up? Like, you were the dude. Like, yep. You were the guy. Could
He's
you imagine Randy Gregory and Jalen Smith coming off one side? Oh, my goodness. It's just, it just hurts my heart to talk about it. Man.
Yeah. Ooh. Yep, see Mr. Soria, Raul.
Let's give him a how about him.
My thoughts on T. Willer is I wish I could wish Mr. T. Will would use his hands every once in a while, but
he only had two drops this year, though.
I know. I just wish he would use his hands.
I'm glad T. Will came back. He was much maligned. I don't know why he's so maligned. I think because he catches the ball with his body and not his hands. But if you look at T. Will, then had some big catches when we beat the Detroit Lions in the playoffs. It was him that caught that big catch. Toe drag swag. He does them. And people forget, he blocks so well downfield. Terrence Williams, I mean, he opens the line. When they run outside and they're running the ball, they run to his side a lot because he puts his body on those cornerbacks. And he's not a little guy. He's 6'3", about 220 pounds. It's not like he's a little dude. I like T. Will coming back in the fold, and I like the continuity that he brings with Dez, Beasley, Butler, Witten. I like our combination with those guys. And Mr. Akers, that you're a Steeler fan, like to let you know we did beat you in Pittsburgh, and you probably see the highlights right here. Just to let you know. Oh, hey, diehard Cowboy fans, Mr. DeCal, I like T.J. Watt as myself, but I really love McKinney from UCLA. Now, the only problem I have with McKinney is, you know Anthony Barr that came from UCLA? I wanted him, and the Minnesota Vikings scooped him up. UCLA players are suspects sometimes. They're either going to be really good or they're going to be really bad. So that's what I worry about with McKinley. But if you watch his get off, he's only 252 pounds. He's like 6'2", but he reminds me of an Elmas Duverville,
He's got the potential to be that dude, though.
He's just one of those guys that's feisty and after the line. So I would love to get him. T.J. Watt, I like him as well. I think he'd be a great addition because he comes from a good lineage. And the Watt brothers seem like they just play hard. I want guys that's going to play hard. And
that's
if you're
high
playing
motor.
With Sean Lee, he's just going to make you
and
play
Jalen
better.
Smith.
And Jalen Smith. And, hey, another player. Oh, when we're talking about breakout players on the defensive side, I like Damian Wilson. I don't know about y'all, but from Minnesota, when we saw him last year, Ron Marinelli was sending him on timely blitzes, and he was in that backfield. If he can step up, too, because he has good size, the only problem with Damian Wilson is he tends to be over-aggressive and he overruns plays.
Yeah.
But if he can stay disciplined, I like him, Sean Lee, and Jalen Smith as a linebacking core. That is a nice core to me.
See, Mr. Gonzalez, David Gonzalez says, isn't Doomerville still on the market? And yes, he is. We kind of talked about that
you
I think
like
last week. I like him. He's a big body. He's definitely going to give us a pass rush presence, but he might be asking a little too much. I think it's his problem for where he's at in his career.
I think he should just be a specialist, somebody more third like down. What's our guy, Dwight Freeney, one of those guys that could just come off the line, maybe at third down situations and attack the line. But to me, I want to keep the line young and fresh. I think those type of guys, you keep them young, you keep them fresh, but I think we need at least two strong defensive ends in the draft to make a difference as far as us going forward. Because if we don't have pressure, you can have the greatest linebackers, you can have the greatest corners. I don't care if you got Darrell Revis, Richard Sherman, Patrick Peterson. I don't care if you got Trufant back there. If you can't rush the passer, Seattle is good, yes, you got Richard Sherman, but who do they got rushing the passer? Michael Bennett. Yeah, you had before Bruce Irvin. They have guys that can get out the quarterback, and that makes you better as a corner and a safety no matter what you play.
Whenever you got to make the quarterback do something that's out of his routine or rhythm, you know, it's in your favor every time. So that presence is called disruption for a reason.
You've
got
to disrupt the quarterback. You agree with me, G, on that, you got to be able to rush the quarterback. Would you agree, Producer G?
Absolutely. I mean, I wish we had DeMarcus Ware now.
I mean,
we still might. Him and Romo might come back at the same time holding hands.
I would love to see that. But like I said, I'm beating a dead horse, Cowboy fans. I'm beating a dead horse. pass rushers, pass rushers, pass rushers. That's what we need. I don't. Our team is set. No matter what anybody tells me, our team is set. Pass rushers.
Yep. That's why I like the kid out of Missouri, and I like Taco possibly at the end of the first round.
Taco Chart.
I like Taco.
He's a big Charles guy. Smith from
UCLA. McKinley.
Missouri. I think those Charles guys Smith. Are good. They got a kid named Basem. He's from Ohio University. Not in the first round, but look for him in the fourth round. Actually, not to just prelude to a few things, but you know the draft is coming up. We're going to have a good draft specialist because guess what? I got a little lazy.
Uh-oh.
Because, you know, I haven't been an internet guy. I've just been on the internet maybe 10 years as far as this and that. But back in the day when I was with the wifey and the kids, I used to always get Pro Football Weekly draft. Pro Football Weekly, and they broke down every single player in the draft. So I'm going back to the books because we're going to have our draft special here in a little bit. So I'm going back to the
sleepers.
Books, and I'm going to pull out some sleepers, and we're going to match wits and heads, and we're going to see if we get them players right. Because this year, Cowboy fans, is the draft that we must hit on because it's too deep defensively not to make it happen this year.
This year.
Ooh, I like it.
This is our year.
But no matter what you say, got to have the playmakers. If you don't have playmakers, you can't do the difference. And like I said, Jason Garrett, you got to make it happen. Ron Marinelli, if he gets the players he's proven like he had in Tampa Bay, when they had 328 sacks in his tenure. 5 seasons they had the most sack totals in Bucs history. So he's proven that if he gets the players to get after the quarterback, because Ron Manera, no matter how much we want him to blitz all the time, he's not blitzing. He's staying in the cover 2. He's staying in the cover 3. He's all about pressure.
Let's get the players that can handle that.
Quarterback, I mean, you can make plays in the back end.
We need that Derek Brooks type player in his system, you know, because he comes out of that.
That's what Jalen Smith can be in my
eyes. And that's, I think, we'll be all right.
What you think, Jay? Jalen Smith.
You know, I'm not listening.
He's paying attention to other stuff. But anyway, now, hey, we were talking about Cowboy fans. Biggest steal in Cowboys draft history. We've thrown out some names. I threw out some names. So you tell me, JK.
Yeah.
What's your biggest steal in Cowboys draft history? Biggest steal.
I had to go back and do a little bit of research just to see who all was worthy of that nomination.
Wait, real quick. Just keep that thought because we got a couple. How about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah! How about them? I thought we were going uno mas on that.
I thought we was doubling up on the high box on Cowboys. It's all good, though.
So, no, but we're going draft steals. So, like I said, I looked it up a little bit to make sure I could look at some stuff. And Jay Ratliff, that's a very good nomination that came up. But me personally, I was looking at it, and it's Herschel Walker. Because we got him in the 5th round coming out of the USFL.
Mm-hmm.
So we get him for like 2 or 3 years. We get a very productive year out of him, like a 1,500-yard year. Mm-hmm. Trade him for, you know, our dynasty pretty much. And then end up getting him back at the end of his career, play fullback for us and kick returner. I think that's one of the biggest steals. He made the franchise for the 90s, so I think that was huge to pick him up.
Yeah, now people have been saying Larry Allen. The only reason why I'm not going to say Larry Allen's not the biggest steal because he still got drafted high. I think he still went in the 2nd round of the draft. Now, that's a kind of high for you to be a steal because you're supposed to produce. So for me, a steal to me, because I watched him, is Roger Staubach. Because he was drafted in the 10th round. I know he had the military duty, but think about it. Drafted in the 10th round, and he did not play football for 5 years. And then he comes back, and he wins 2 Super Bowls with Dallas, and Roger Dodger was the man. So for me, he's our biggest steal. Witness close, but people also don't talk about another guy, and this is for you old heads out there, Harvey Martin, who was with Randy White and Ed Tuttle Jones. Harvey Martin came in the late 3rd round pick. And DeMarcus Ware just passed him as the all-time sack leader. Harvey Martin had 114 sacks in only 158 games. To me,
beast.
That is a steal.
How about you, G? You got one on that? No? Mm-mm.
I hear Dustin say, Gavin Escobar, that's a definite ha-ha. I'm glad he is gone. I ain't hating on you, Gavin Escobar, but we should have never picked you.
Hopefully Rico Gathers can be that steal.
Exactly. Escobar, man, I don't even want to get off on the bus anymore because, I mean, that was actually terrible.
All right, Donnie, how about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah, how about them Cowboys?
How about them?
Yes. Oh, I think Witten was actually a – wasn't Witten a 3rd rounder? Witten was actually a third rounder.
I think that was a good spot for him. I don't think he was that highly. I don't think it was a steal. I think that's where he was about to go.
Yeah, he was. They were projecting him around that.
I think the productivity we got is a steal, obviously, exactly. But his draft value at the time was
exactly
right. It was spot on.
I totally agree. Now we had another question on here that we were also talking about with Randy Gregory. I hate to come back to him, but people have talked about, should he have the jersey number 94?
Man, nope. You got that buzzer still, G? Man. No,
we're gonna have to bring that buzzer back.
Gotta bring that buzzer back just for that question, because no, he doesn't get that 94. I think if he comes, if he comes back and plays another snap for the Cowboys, you better put that boy in 49, 91, whatever's available, but it should not be 94.
I totally agree, because 94 has been a standard. DeMarcus Ware, Charles Haley, guys who brought it on the field and stayed relatively off the field with no issues. And to me, it's you're representing that number. You have to represent it all the way.
It goes hand in hand with the thing we were talking about with the quarterbacks earlier. And there's 88 at the receiver position. And I think after the Antonio Bryant disaster, they've kind of learned that you gotta be decent to get that number. You're not gonna get 82 for a while either.
That's another number. I don't think they should be ever let people wear. I mean, even if his number doesn't get retired, that's one number. 82.
Only problem is here in about 10, 15 years, we might run out of numbers.
Yeah,
because 4 and 21 are gonna come up. So,
and 21,
that whole offensive line, those numbers could be gone.
I was scared for Zeke to get number 21 because Julius Jones had 21 and he fell off. And Joseph Randall had 21. He was terrible with us. So I was like, dang, Zeke, get something else. Don't get 21. But guess what? He's proved it wrong. So keep that 21 and make it happen, man.
Don't want to see him in 22 yet.
No.
It'd be nice if they let him switch to it eventually, but I just don't think it's going to happen. No, there's no point. Marketing wouldn't happen.
I see you, Beck, when you're talking about tight end. I think, like I said, we got Swain. I like Gathers. Maybe we can get another guy in free agency. But to me, with
Witten
all our picks in our draft, it's got to be defensive heavy. Like, you've seen some teams where it's pretty much all defense in that draft. I mean, this has to be that draft. Linebackers, corners, DNs. We have to stockpile. We can get guys free agents.
We got 6 picks?
I think we got 7.
7?
Because
then you need to go 5 to 6 of them on defense.
At least the first 4.
Yeah.
Did you catch Dustin Merriman's question there? He said, do you see the Cowboys trading back up in the draft?
No,
I don't think so. I think standing pat at 28 is still good because the draft is so deep.
I want to keep what we have right now.
I don't want to lose draft picks because our draft picks are so premium this year because we have to nail on the draft. So I don't want us to see trade up because I don't want to lose the surplus of picks that we have now. I think we'll find somebody good at 28. If you look at the history of the Cowboys lately, we've been picking really good as far as drafting late.
Keep it up. Another solid draft.
Bryant, we got Byron Jones, Travis Frederick. We got those guys that were in later picks in the deep later part of the first round. So I say we stay pat, get somebody at 28. And I think our first and second and third round picks are going to be the ones we really have to nail on this year for our defense. No trading up, no trading down. As far as with Morris, I mean, I heard some people try to trade him.
For Claiborne? Are you talking about for Alfred?
No, I mean, I think we get a compensatory for Claiborne.
I said, is that what you're talking about, Dustin? You talking about getting compensatory picks for Claiborne?
I don't know, but he did say something about Morris, too.
Yeah, because he's talking about trading picks, and I do kind of like – he's talking about Alfred. I don't think anybody wants him.
I think
him
he's
for
saying
anything.
What would someone trade for Alfred Morris?
Yeah.
Nothing?
Nothing. Nothing. Bag of balls.
Bag of tennis balls. I'm not hating on Alfred Morris.
Two footballs and a...
But I just don't think he has the explosion that we need for our offense. We need somebody to explode through that hole, and he's just not a guy that's going to do that. I think McFadden is the person. I think we can get somebody. I remember, people don't want to talk about this, but Joe Mixon, nobody was talking about him because he was, he had gotten in trouble and nobody maybe want to put their hands on him. But Joe Mixon is the truth. If he fell to us, I would have to want him.
Yeah, I would keep Morris as the third string running back. Keep him as, he's a good goal line back. We don't have to use him much. Keep him fresh. I just don't think anybody's really going to give up much for him unless there's injuries and we don't want to see that.
What is he going to do though? He's not going to start for you. He's not a starting back anymore. He's a backup. So why would you trade a pick for a backup?
Right.
He's not a starting running back in the NFL anymore. Alfred Morris is not going to go to another NFL team and start a 16-game season. That is not happening. His years are behind him. He's about to be 28 years old. His best years are behind him. He's a career backup now. He's not starting for any other team in the NFL. So roll with McFadden. get another running back behind him. And if we can trade him, cool, but I just don't see Morris doing anything for us.
It feels like a lot of Cowboys fans are interested in Adrian Peterson. What do you guys think about that?
He's only a two-down runner now. I mean, what can Adrian Peterson offer us? I mean, Zeke is the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Peterson's not coming off the bench for him, and he can only give you two downs.
He's going to go to probably like – I saw he's visiting the Patriots, and I feel like that's – I said that since the day he got released. He's either going to go to Green Bay or New England. And so I feel like he's going to end up in New England. It just makes – so much stupid sense for them to do that because that's just the way they.
That's the Patriot way.
They'll get him for a decent price. They'll give him incentives, and they won't give him the ball enough to get those incentives. So it'll be a cheap contract for them. He'll still perform because you know he's passionate, wants to win a Super Bowl. So why wouldn't he go there? That just makes sense. They got rid of LeGarrette Blount. That's where he's going.
I totally agree, and I'm listening to Drew. He's got some good stuff over here. I was hearing what you were saying about the kid from Bryan Hill from Wyoming. I have seen him, and I also seen Jamal Williams from BYU. I like I said, the sleeper picks because those are the guys that nobody's going to be talking about. And it's like this. When you get a team and you're winning and you have guys that are playing good, they start setting a standard. Mm-hmm. So the people that you get after them, behind them, they're going to want to stay to that standard. So you're not going to really get the slouches or the guys that aren't really performing because if you're not going to perform, we have too good of a players that you're not going to stay here.
We have so much talent on the team right now. It should be making everybody else want to play better and be better. So it's a good situation to be in.
I totally agree.
I don't
on the AP thing.
And I don't think I would give Jamal Charles a shot either. I saw David's question come through about that.
Knee injuries.
Those rubber bands are ready to snap again, so I don't think I would at this point. I think I'm happy with McFadden and Morris, and you know, like I said, maybe we take a mix in somewhere or something like that and figure something out.
I totally agree. And, hey, I hear you, Peel.
That's
Curtis
your boy.
Samuel. I mean, we're in Ohio.
Yep.
Great weather out here. I'm not giving you that OH.
Well, somebody else will respect that.
It's the Longhorns over here. I got to get
G. Can I get OH? OH? Can you just give me an IO?
OH.
IO. That's not what I wanted.
See, that's what I mean.
Okay.
See, that's what
I'm not Buckeye like you, though.
Oh, Dustin Merriman. My thoughts on Tapper. Hey, go to our Facebook page or go to our website, silverandbluenation.com.
Yep.
And check out the article, the blog I wrote on Charles Tapper. I said he was the forgotten man. Because if you look at it, nobody's talking about Charles Tapper. I mean, nobody is like – it's like we don't even have him on the roster. Nobody's talking about him. If you watched him at Oklahoma, he was very good. The only thing with Oklahoma is they didn't use him the right way because they were using him more as a run stopper. Even on the defensive end, he was supposed to just stop the gaps. But they weren't really releasing him off the edge. 6'2", 270 pounds, running a 4.59. Hey, I love him at his chances in – Oklahoma, they bring out good players. I mean, they bring out good defensive players. So I personally love and can't wait to see what Tapper brings to the table. I'm excited for him. I think he's going to bring something. I hope he does because let's say if he's that edge rusher that we have, it just makes our team, oh, my gosh, just so much better. I totally agree.
Yeah, if his back can stay healthy, I think he's going to be a good addition to our line.
It's scary. Back injuries do scare me. Look at DeMarcus Lawrence. He's had two of them, and it basically zapped his whole power last year.
Yep.
I mean, he basically sat out, three games because of that back injury?
Somewhere around there.
And even when he came back, he really didn't do anything. He really didn't produce. So hopefully with him getting all the way better, we're going to see. For me, DeMarcus Lawrence, this is your year that you must produce. You got the ASAC year. Okay. I need to see 10 sacks. If you're going to show me something, DeMarcus Lawrence has to get 10 sacks this year. If he's not getting 10 sacks this year, I don't know if we're re-signing him to some kind of major contract because his contract is going to be up here too.
Yep.
And remember, we traded up to get him in the second round, so he has to produce because that's a second-round pick.
Yeah, if we can get Malik Collins to step up, David Irving to step up again, you know, it's just going to make everybody else better. You know, get Charles Tapper on that line, then so you get Jalen Smith back there with Sean Lee. Oh, man.
And nobody talks about Malik Collins. I said it before. Malik Collins is a beast. I love when we drafted him out of
Dustin's
the third round
that.
Out of Nebraska. 5 sacks. I compared him to Russell Maryland. I saw Maryland when he was with the Cowboys with those Super Bowl runs. Russell Maryland was a dog. But his best season with the Cowboys was 4.5 sacks. Collins has already got that his first year, 5 sacks. Great size, 6'2", 310 pounds, aggressive. And like I checked the article, once again, go on our website, silverandbluenation.com. Check out the website because I also gave another blog about him, and I basically was letting people know he was a great wrestler in high school, 48-5 his junior year, 48-0 his senior year, state champion.
Strong.
If you can wrestle, I'm telling you, if you're a great wrestler, it translates to the football field. That hand movement, the hand fighting.
Footwork.
The footwork, the quickness,
the
power.
The core strength that
exactly,
it takes.
Exactly, and the mental, because wrestlers have to lose weight. They have to make weight, and that's a lot of mental preparation that they have to do, and I think that's why he's so good. So I think Collins is going to be another awesome player on the line. We just need that defensive player. I don't know about you, but we need that defensive player.
Yeah, I was comparing him to Jay Ratliff. That's who I kind of – my comparison was for Collins.
Yeah, that's who G saw. That was kind of his era, so I like that comparison.
Appreciate everybody's comments. Keep them coming in. Like, we need more stuff to talk about, so hit us with your comments.
Yeah, I just saw Dustin's comment come through, man, and I want to touch on a little bit.
Byron Jones. What do you think about Byron Jones?
Man, I love that guy, too. When he's coming out of the draft, you know, those combine stats obviously were just – blown off page.
I wrote an article on him.
He's so quick and he's so talented. I want to see him succeed, but I agree, man. He looks lost, especially if you look at that last play before the field goal in the divisional game. He was lost. He just let the guy behind him, like, nothing will happen. And dime dropped right over top of his head. You got to not look like a deer in the headlights there.
I mean, I'm not going to say that about him. The only thing, I like Byron Jones, but I just don't think he's the playmaker at the free safety spot. I think I don't know what he is. I think he could be a steady corner, but he's not a guy that's going to get picks. To me, he can cover. He can cover tight ends. He can cover corners, but he's not a guy that's getting five or six picks.
I'm okay with cover right now because you look at the receivers in our division again. We need cover corners right now, and having him at safety, being able to play coverage, get somebody to play the strong, be able to come up in the run, it's going to help out. I like him, but we need that. We need coverage.
I mean, that's why we have to draft on the back end as well, so we have to get a safety as well. Because me personally, I think Jeff Heath, everybody talks about Heath, I think Jeff Heath is more of a free safety and a playmaker than Byron Jones. But I don't think Byron Jones is a strong safety. So that's why I would like to see Jones slide in at the corner spot. Kayvon Frazier, we don't know about him, but he was great on special teams. He is a thumper. He's a guy that attacks the line of scrimmage. He attacks hits. I like to see Heath at really free safety slide Byron Jones back at maybe a corner, and then draft maybe a safety back there, maybe a couple safeties. But I just don't think Jones is a playmaker at the free safety. I just don't see him getting 4 to 5 to 6 picks every single year. I just don't see that from him. Even when he was at UConn, he wasn't that type of player that was getting picks.
He's just
a smart player. He's around the ball. He's very intelligent. But he's not a guy that's going to get you a lot of picks every single year. And at the end of the day, we need guys that can get crucial picks. A third name, we got Eli Manning. We got Kirk Cousins. I think Carson Wentz is going to be better year two. Just like I was looking on a question right here. You got Brandon Marshall coming in with the Giants now. You got Alshon Jeffrey, Torrey Smith with the Philadelphia Eagles. Terrell Pryor goes with the Washington Redskins. They got guys, Dotson.
Odell Beckham.
And Odell Beckham.
We didn't mention him yet.
And Shepard. That three combo. We need corners and we need playmakers. So we need guys that can not only cover, but we need guys that can make these interceptions and these picks.
Yeah. To touch on what Ron was talking about there, to start looking for a tight end, I personally am hoping that we already have him in Rico Gathers. I think he's going to be a freak. Hopefully he's our steal, one of our future draft steals. Hopefully that will show up one day.
I think
Landon Collins. Don't mention that.
Who said Landon Collins?
Dustin.
Could we had a Landon Collins? I think we could have had him.
Byron Jones instead.
If we could have had Landon, I would trade Landon Collins, Byron Jones in a heartbeat. That dude is ridiculous.
He is a monster.
Landon Collins is a ridiculous. Drew, I think Anthony Brown will take the next step? I do too. I really do. I think
I hate to agree with you on everything. I really do. I don't like you that much, but I agree. We do agree on stuff.
It's the wisdom. It's the wisdom and knowledge.
It's just the common denominator. Okay. Cowboys and
Anthony Brown is going to be a beast. That was a great pick. For real, I'm going to just be honest with you, Cowboy fans. I studied that draft so hard last year, who we drafted. And when I say we picked him, because number one, we're in Ohio, so we see the Big Ten. We see
a lot
and
of
if
it.
You look at Dallas, they got quite a few Big Ten players on the team. I mean, we got Sean Lee. We got Anthony Brown. Anthony Hitchens is from Purdue as well.
Mention him.
Damian Wilson.
Mention him.
Zeke.
I mean,
we got a lot of guys.
They're around.
We got a lot of guys from the Big Ten. And Big Ten players are usually good players. SEC, Big Ten, they're usually players that produce. So when I seen us get Anthony Brown in the sixth round, and I seen what he ran, 4'4", 4'3", fast, aggressive, can tackle. I think he takes the next level. I think he's definitely a player that we can look forward to next year. I definitely am excited to see him next year.
I agree. What you got? Let's go through here. KB is a good man.
I mean, I see you, Leon, where he's talking about we lost our edge not playing our starters. I don't really agree with that. I don't agree we lost our edge in that Philly game. We had a slow start on the offensive side, but we made a lot of just silly mistakes, a lot of errors. I mean, think about what killed us, the Bryce Butler coming in the huddle when we had just got a first down.
Right.
I mean, that killed us. We had a first down on that drive. We were about to score.
You saw how they changed that too, right?
Yeah.
They'll give a warning now for that, which is freaking ridiculous because that does nothing for us retroactively to go back to that game, that's so annoying.
But think about the game. If you were watching that game, we had the ball. We were driving a few times to score,
that killed
but those
momentum.
Penalties killed us.
A few Doug Free penalties.
Doug Free
and then
penalties,
that one especially. That
penalty,
one was huge. And it wasn't
just got a 20-yard gain on that play.
Yes, that was a fresh set of downs. It was on a heck of a play, too. Like I think Dak had to scramble and hit – I can't remember who, but he had to make a heck of a play to even get the first down. Butler doesn't even come. It wasn't even a huddle.
Right.
It was a muddled – just mess. He never. I don't know. I hate that. That's stupid.
I think that just really. I don't agree with our starters resting that game as far as us losing our momentum. I didn't really see that happening. I just saw that we shot ourselves in the foot, and I just think you had a couple bad calls in that game. I mean, think about it. We came back against these guys, but as I said before, Green Bay played out of their mind that game. I know we had a bump in the road, but Green Bay played out of their mind. Aaron Rodgers threw passes that I was just like, are you serious? I mean, think about it. When he threw that pass to Rodgers for the touchdown, and it went right through Sean Lee's hands. I mean, he threw it right over his hands.
It hurt.
Fell right in there. You got guys who are making tippy-toe catches that they did make in the Atlanta game, scrambling, running around, completing 35-yard passes. And the key to me
– you saw those 50-50 balls.
Crosby hitting a 56-yarder, then coming back and hitting two back-to-back 50-yarders. When does that happen? When does that happen?
Only
and
against us.
We get the interception with Jeff Heath, and then we get the penalty. Yep. Like, come on, man. That was just one of those games where it's like, you know what? We just might lose.
Then Byron game. Jones got lost.
Let him leave him alone, man.
I'm just saying.
Let him go. You know what I'm saying? So, Myles Garrett. Oh, we're not trading up to get Myles Garrett. We will never do something like that, but I love him.
He said he should fail a drug test on purpose.
That's the guy. That is to me, the dude that would take us to the next level. If we could get like somebody like a Myles Garrett, that is the guy that's going to take it to the next level. No matter what anybody says, in my heart, pass rushers, I'm going to beat it. We need pass rushers. Look at all these teams that win. What do you think? Why do you think Oakland got better? It wasn't just because of Derek Carr. Because they had Khalil Mack.
Yep. Started on defense.
Denver wasn't great. Was good, but when they got Von Miller, it became great.
You see what Tavares said?
What's that?
We probably win that game against Packers if we have Randy Gregory on the field.
Yes.
That is probably a true statement. He said Goodell knew it, and you might be right. That's what we're missing, man. I agree with you, man.
Tavares, I totally agree with you with that. It was kind of like, why would you let this guy play? Why would you let this guy play two games just to suspend him for the playoffs? To me, right. I'm thinking, like, you must have knew, Goodell, that if Randy Gregory is playing for the Cowboys in the playoffs, we're going to beat you.
We're going deep.
In the playoffs, and you don't want to see that. Mm-mm. So I don't know if it's a conspiracy theory, but there was no reason to let him play two games only to suspend him for the playoffs. That was ridiculous. I don't understand why they did, but that's behind the scenes. But, man, it hurt my heart and soul when Gregory played that Philly game, got his first sack. I was like, yes. And then they were like, oh, he may not be able to play for the playoffs. I'm like, okay, there goes the hate. You know what I mean? There goes the hate. And
there
I don't like the hate. And there's a lot of haters on the Cowboys.
Look at all these emojis flying on the screen. I love it.
We love these emojis. We love these.
They're
and Cowboy fans, we love y'all. And we appreciate y'all tuning in. Make sure, like I tell you about, follow us on Twitter at SBNation17. Don't forget to go to the website, silverandbluenation.com. You already see us on Facebook, Silver Blue Nation.
Get on
we
that Instagram.
All we're all about the Cowboys. We
Silver
can't
blue.
Wait till the season starts. We were also talking about the opponents. What do you think our record is going to be this year?
Man, there's an opportunity to go like 13-3 again,
mm-hmm.
and there's an opportunity to go like 8-8, depending on how the division games play out. And then we've got to look at some of those games against, like, you know, the Packers, We got the Falcons on there.
Seahawks.
And the Raiders are going to be tough. The Chiefs.
The Broncos.
Like I said, as a fan.
The Chargers play is tough.
Oh, man. When I look at the schedule, I'm like, we're great. We'll be fine. And I look at it with my Cowboys eyes. And then I look at it with my heart, and I'm like, I don't know, man. That's a tough schedule.
I mean,
that ain't no cake schedule.
Do we have the Cardinals in the regular season this year?
Yes. I believe so.
Yes, we got the Cardinals. We have the Seahawks. We have the Packers. We have the Falcons. We have
Broncos,
the whole AFC
Raiders.
West, and all those teams are going to play us good. They always usually give us problems. Then we have our own division games.
Right. Every team in our division has been making small improvements, and especially all the improvements they've made have been towards our weaknesses.
Exactly.
So this is going. If we lose half our division games, we could be 8-8 this year. And I hate to say that.
I'm going to say, I see you, receiver 14-2. I'm sorry, I just don't see 14-2 unless we get those big dogs on the front line. Me personally, I'm kind of listening to what you, Drew. I'm thinking maybe a 10-6 and 11-5.
I think 11-5 is where I'd settle.
11-5 is what we're looking at this year, because of the opponents we're going
to
play.
Hey, to be fair, we did lead the league in the most wins versus teams with winning records last season.
Yes,
I would love
to keep it up. Yeah.
Yes, we did. And I mean, we played against, and it seems like when we played those good teams, we played better.
Yes.
So that's what I like. I don't want to play a weak schedule, because guess what? All the Cowboys haters were like, your schedule's weak.
That's
going to
get us ready
nobody.
For the playoffs.
But you,
that's where they're going.
This is what we need. We need a tough, hard schedule. And that's why I think it's okay to be 11-5.
11-5 still gets you to the playoffs.
It
gets you a couple losses to where you're not walking around with so much swagger that, you know, you can't fit your head in your helmet. It kind of keeps you down to earth a little bit.
Okay, I'm listening to you.
You see Ryan?
Right.
Ryan Dye, what's up, man? How about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys, Dye? Are you worried about Dak and Zeke being a one and done? I don't definitely think Zeke is too good of a player. He's a one world kind of generation type player. So I don't see him falling off because he's just too good. And I think Dak, I mean, look at him in Mississippi. People forget. Look at him in Mississippi State. I mean, he didn't have talent at Mississippi State, and look what he brought to that team. Look what he brought to that college. Look what he brought to that university. He was a winner. That's the biggest thing when he was at Mississippi State. He was a winner.
I got a lot of faith in him to continue to do the same thing he did last year, both of them.
I don't see
I watched Zeke here at Ohio State. Obviously, he's not one and done.
No. He's too good.
Zeke is everything he is touted to be. Mm-hmm. And that is obvious if you watch any bit of his career. He's going to continue to be what he is for a while.
So
Dak is, I think, a good young kid. I think he's got a good head on his shoulders. Mm-hmm. You know, the whole incident before the draft really helped him slide to us. We talked about him getting draft last year, possibly in the second round.
2-10 and out.
Right? We said something about that.
Yep.
And, you know, we ended up getting him, fourth? Mm-hmm. So that's a steal there. And I just think he's motivated to play. He's got a good head on his shoulders right now. And I think he's going to be good for us. He's too poised to make me worry right now.
And I believe Dak sees the history that he had before him. And I believe he wants to live to a legacy. I think he wants to create his own legacy. So I don't see him falling off. And as I said before, you look at what they did in college and high school. He was a winner in high school. He was a winner in college. And I feel like that translates. That's not by chance. Does anybody remember Jake Locker?
Yeah, Jake Locker was an animal at Washington.
But what was the biggest thing with him? His completion percentage at Washington was always around 54, 55, 56%.
Right.
And he always threw interceptions. And people were saying, as good as he was talent-wise, he was going to throw picks in the NFL. And guess what happened? He threw a lot of picks, and his completion percentage was not good.
And he got concussions just like in college, too.
So
he suffered the same thing. So,
I mean, you don't all of a sudden –
you can learn a lot from players' college careers.
You don't all of a sudden never do all this stuff in the pros, and then the college, and then you do it in the pros. It doesn't work like that.
When you're throwing 65, 70% completion rate, and you're doing it for a 5-6-year stretch, including college,
That's what you are, and that's who you are.
Yep.
So if you're not completing a lot of good passes in college, you're not going to do it in the pros, because think about it. You're playing against the best of the best. You're not playing against a third stringer in a college or anything like that.
Right.
You're playing against the best of the best. These coordinators are paid big money to stop you. They will get tape on you, and they will shut you down. So if you're a winner in college, most likely it's going to translate with you being a winner in the pros, and I think that's what Dak brings to the table. And I just think he has too much heart and love for the game to see him fall off. I don't see that happening.
So John asked about Dak not being able to throw down the field. I think that was more of Linehan and Garrett kind of restricting that last year. There was a couple plays last year, I'm sure you guys probably saw it as well, where Dez is running wide open down the field with his hand up,
and
he didn't even see him. Yep. But I don't think he was even coached to look down there right now. I think it was more of, yes, the 7-8 yard passes, but he's not a rookie anymore, and we're going to expect him. You're an NFL quarterback. You want to be elite. You have to make 20, 30, 40-yard throws down the field. So I think we're going to see a little bit of different stuff this year with that.
I totally agree with you. I think it was more of, let's not try to turn the ball over. You're a rookie, so let's keep the mistakes at a minimum. So, yes, we'll take the opportunities when they're there, but if they're not there, let's make the safe play, because guess what? We have a running game. We don't have to throw 30, 40-yard bombs every single play because we have a great running back. We have a great offensive line, so it's going to take the pressure. When we can get Zeke going and then we do the play action, that's when you see Dez Bryant getting open.
T-Will and
that's
Dez.
When you see T-Will. People forget. Look at the completion. Look what the deep pass he threw to Pittsburgh with Dez Bryant. Mm-hmm. Look at the deep pass he threw. We're looking right here in the Minnesota game where he threw the deep one to Dez. The other one he threw to Bryce Butler that was on a dime, like a 60-yard, and Bryce Butler dropped it.
Yep.
There's plenty of times he's looked downfield and thrown completions, but year two, yes, we do need to throw the ball downfield more because I think more defensive coordinators are going to sit on those shorter routes. They're going to be looking for those slant.
It's going to be open. He's going to be more trained to look for it,
and he's got to look for it. It's got to be in him to step up and throw those deeper passes to give the respect so they don't have the 8-9 men in the box for Zeke.
He sees the field well enough. He's not going to miss those. He's got a full season full of watching film and, you know, progressing. I think just watching Dez run open and seeing the film, you know, when you're breaking it down, he's like, oh, dude, I missed that. It's going to be in the back of your head. You're gonna see it on your progression.
He sees it, too.
He's a smart young kid, so I think he's going to pick up on it, and I think we'll be all right.
Yeah, he's a guy that's going to get in the film room. He's a guy that's going to see his mistakes. He's a guy who's going to see Dez open. And the more they play with each other, Dez is a passionate player. Dez is a player that loves you. So I feel like their bond is going to grow even stronger because they have genuine love for each other. They're going to be on the offseason. They're going to be doing the quarterback receiver routes. They're going to be doing the route tree. I believe Dez has got to do the route tree to get even better. But I believe that them two in year two with Scott Linehan back in the fold, I think he's going to do wonders. I think that Dak may not have the crazy, maybe only 4 picks again this year. I think his interception may come up just a little bit, but I think yards, maybe more touchdowns. That's what I would like to see. Maybe 30 touchdowns this year, maybe 8 picks, maybe about 3,800 yards passing, 65 completion percentage. That's a great year to me.
He's going to have a good year. We've mentioned him briefly as being the breakout player on offense too, and just kind of like, eh. I think we kind of expect him to have a good year, and I don't think he's going to go out and necessarily throw for like 50 touchdowns, 5,000 yards or anything. But
we don't need
Dak
to do that.
We don't want or need that.
We don't need Dak to throw 50 touchdowns. We need Zeke to get that 1,600 yards every year, and Dak to be around 35 to 4,000 yards every year, and that's a successful blend of offense. I want to see Dez get back to those 80 catches. Mm-hmm. I like to see Beasley around those 75 catches. I like
1,000 yards.
I like to see Terrence Williams with about 50 catches. Maybe Bryce Butler about 30, 40 catches. Jason Witten is going to get his about 60 catches, 60 to 65.
I don't want to see Bryce Butler, like I said. I want to see him break out, but I don't want to see him with 70, 80 catches because that means Beasley, Dez, or Terrence, somebody's not getting the ball, and I want them getting the ball over Bryce Butler.
I definitely agree. But Bryce Butler, I was listening to you. Bryce Butler definitely needs to step up this year. He's just got to be more consistent. That's the thing with him, just like with David Irvin. Those guys have to be more consistent. Bryce Butler, when he comes in the game, you look at his size. He's a big dude. I mean, he's big like Dez Bryant, 6'3", 216 pounds. But you can't have those mental lapses. So when we're throwing those passes, a 15-yard pass, he catches some of those, but some of those he drops. And when he drops them, it's a third down and like an 8. We got to have him more consistent for us to be even going to a higher level as far as our offensive goes. But to me, it's not about our offense. It's not about our offense. It's about our defense.
It is.
No matter what anybody says, it's about our defense. If we don't get that defense together, we're just going to keep having failures. I don't care. People say offense, offense, offense. To me, defense wins games. You have to be able to shut people down. You got to get people off the field on third down. That is a huge down. And when it's a third and 8, how many times, Cowboy fans, let's talk. How many times have we seen Cowboy games when it's 3rd and 8, 3rd and 6, 3rd and 7, and we're coming back or we have a lead and they hit a big 15, 16, 20-yard game, and it breaks our back.
All too often, my friend.
You know what I'm saying? And that's been the theme for Dallas for so long is too many times we give up the big pass. We give up. We didn't give up big runs this year. We were number one in rushing defense with allowing only 83.5 yards a game. So we definitely shut down the run. But this year, we can't have those big plays. We didn't give up a lot of big plays, but we can't give up a 30-yard gain, a 40-yard gain. When we have to get those guys off the field, the more times we get those guys off the field on third down, we're coming back and scoring. Yep. We have a lead of a 14-0 lead.
And I hate to say it, you notice when the pass defense really started to struggle last year? Was when Claiborne went down.
I mean,
and honestly, like
You keep talking about Claiborne, he's gone.
I'm just stating my observation of last year.
Okay.
When he went down, our pass coverage took a drastic hit.
Okay. Well, you know what? He still got hurt.
But he wasn't around for the next, 14 games. So
he wasn't around the last nine games of the season. Yeah. And even when he did come back, we were putting our hedging our bets on him. And guess what? He gets hurt in the first quarter and a half, and he doesn't play the rest of the game.
Yep.
No hate on you, Morris Claiborne, but see ya.
Yeah, so I think he can play. He just can't stay healthy.
Yeah, exactly. We need somebody. Aaron Rock. I mean,
that would have been Randy Gregory. Oh, that would have been.
Man.
But, yeah, we need a defense.
But David Irvin really needs to step up.
He's got some long arms. He needs to take advantage of that.
Crawford, yes. I mean, G just mentioned Crawford. Tyrone, nobody's talking about Tyrone Crawford. He got the big contract, remember, after he had sort of a breakout year. He was on NFL.com as a breakout player. Tyrone Crawford needs to get more than 4 to 5 sacks. You're making $8 to $9 million a year. You have to get more sacks. And I'm noticing a little bit more that he's a lot more injury prone the last 2 years. So you have to stay on the field, Crawford. He's just had another surgery. This is 2 years in a row where he's had off-season surgery. You have to make a difference. I think we have to make a decision on where we're going to play him at. He was better as a defensive tackle to me. So I think getting him, Malik Collins, Stephen Paya in there. Hey, we haven't even talked about Thornton that came over from Cedric Thornton. He's a run stopper. We get those guys to step up in that middle and the pressure off the edges.
So we're looking at one pass rusher, probably a strong safety, and another corner. And we, like you said, the first four picks or so in the draft, we can fill those spots and we'll be good.
Yeah, I mean, you said I hear Beck said who has the most picks. I don't know. Jeff, I think Heath has led us in interceptions the last few years, even though he doesn't get a lot of playing time.
He doesn't get a lot of playing
time. He's always around the ball. Yep. That's the thing I know about Jeff Heath. Yep. He's always around the ball. And can I say this on air? Does he get the knock because he's a white safety?
It's our show. Say what you want.
Does he get the knock because he's a white safety and he's not?
I don't know if that's such a the thing at that position.
But Harrison Smith over in Minnesota.
Yeah, I mean.
But he stands out. You know, he's one of the best safeties in the league.
I mean, y'all remember the guy I was hedging my bets on? What's his name? He kept on getting hurt every single year. He came out of a small school.
There was
the other white dude from East Washington.
Matt Johnson. Yes.
Johnson. That's
Matt
it.
Johnson.
Yeah.
Big cut-up white guy.
Big cut-up guy.
He blew that his hammy out like first practice, and it never healed.
Like, I was waiting for him every single year to just be healthy because I was watching his tape. The dude was around the ball all the time. That's what
he was a freak, too.
He was a freak of nature, but he couldn't stay healthy with them injuries. I think what happened was he bumped into Miles Austin, and he got the hamstring bug. He bumped into him on accident, and he gave him the power. He, touched him with the hamstring. You have the power.
That spoke volumes about our medical staff at the time.
Man, but I like Heath. I think he's a playmaker. I think it's kind of good that we let Church and Wilcox go because, I mean, Church was just a box safety.
It was going to cost too much to keep him. I liked him.
But he wasn't playmaking. Right. And if Jacksonville Jaguars are going to sign you for a four-year deal for that much money, mm-hmm. like Stephen Jones said, go ahead.
Go ahead, LaRont Robinson. Him. Go ahead.
You go ahead. You can go ahead and sign him for that money, but he's not playmaking for us. J.J. Wilcox, this was his only good last year.
Yeah.
He finally stepped up as far as taking better angles, as far as his tackling. But nobody was worried about keeping
him. Would you rather see Frazier or Heath playing next to Jones right now?
We haven't even seen anything from Frazier.
Yeah.
Well, I mean,
Heath because he's played more. But I think Frazier can be a good.
You may just rotate the two of them?
I think he's a good rotation. But once again, we still got to get somebody in the draft.
Yeah.
because quarter and DB, injuries happen.
Start with defensive end. We go corner safety either way.
From there.
Yep.
Oh, so Leon, who was you saying blew that second Giants game? Talk to me. Yeah, everybody. But see, the thing with Heath, everybody looks at what he doesn't do. Yep. Everybody needs to look at what he does do. But you got to look at, he's not playing a lot. So sometimes you might miss an assignment when you're not playing all the time. The more playing time you get,
might be a little more comfortable.
You get more comfortable. Let's see him start a whole 16 games. We don't know what he can do. Let's see him start a 16-game season. He's playmaking when he gets a chance. How would he do what if he gets 16 games?
Looks like we got like 20-some people viewing this. What do you guys think? Heath? Frazier?
Heath.
I see John Leon saying Barry Church. At least so. I'm okay with him being gone.
I'm okay with him being gone as well. He's not a playmaker with us. He was just a box safety.
He was a good player.
We need playmakers. I mean, that's playmakers. Michael Irvin, playmakers. You don't win without playmakers. You don't win without those guys. If you don't have playmakers on your team, you do not win. I don't care who you have. You can have those strong, steady players. You need playmakers. You need difference makers. Those are the guys that get you over the hump and take you to Super Bowls.
Is Scandrick too small to move to safety?
Yes. I think he doesn't have a safety-type body to me. I think, like we were talking before, to me, a great safety person is like a Charles Woodson-type body. Real long and kind of wiry. Those guys
are still thick.
Even Ed Reed. It just seems like those guys that are long, those are like ball hawks. They're not constricted. It seems like when you usually see thick guys that are playing in the safety.
Their hips are real stiff.
Their hips are real stiff, and they can't turn their hips. I don't know about you, but when you're playing the game and a receiver's coming off the edge, if you can't turn their hips, I mean, that's why if you look at the NFL Combine, that's why they put those defensive backs and those safeties through those drills, those backpedal drills, those cones, and the shuttle.
That's why it's more important just 40 times.
They look at those hips, because you cannot be a fast player, but if you know how to use your hips and rotate your body and you have good extension and you're not tight, you have a chance to make it in the NFL.
Yeah. Should we get Sherman and build around him? I don't think you have enough time to build around him.
Don't build around him.
Our window's closing. If anything,
our window's 3 to 4 years.
We put him on there, then yes,
he's a win now.
We're winning this year.
Yes,
that's the game plan. If we get him, we're winning this year. So there's no building around Richard Sherman. No offense, Ron, but we're not building around him. If we get him, it's to win right now.
And I hear you, John McNeil over there. I do think we do need some bigger corners.
Richard Sherman.
He's a bigger corner. I think that's what we need. Scandrick.
I want Gerrion Conley, first round.
Think about it. Scandrick is good. Even Anthony Brown is good. But Anthony Brown is not a big corner. He's only like about 5'11". We need maybe like a 6'1", a 6'2". I like those type of guys. Mm-hmm. We need one of those guys. So that's why I like Sherman. I mean, 28th pick for Sherman. We can still hit in the draft on the defensive end. But mm-hmm. I don't care. If the Seattle Seahawks call the Dallas Cowboys and say, we're giving you Richard Sherman for your 28th pick, and we say no, I'm sorry. That's dumb.
Yeah, I think we take him with 28th pick. Like you said, if we can trade that for him, we don't have to give up anything else. Just swap him. I don't think we're
going to. I mean, come on.
Like I said, as much as I want Conley, and I think he'll probably be there at 28, he's not Richard Sherman.
You don't think Richard Sherman makes us better instantly?
He does. And that's what I'm saying. He's not. Gerrion Conley is not Richard Sherman.
No.
Richard Sherman's going to come in from day one. He's going to shut down that side of the field.
And he's proven what he's going to do.
Yeah, he's going to do it.
And the good thing about Richard Sherman is he already plays in a coverage-type scheme. He plays in a cover scheme. We play the type of defense that fits him.
And he's nasty. He's got that mentality.
He's got a nasty mentality.
People keep saying Jabril Peppers, and I am just not a fan of signing somebody who just doesn't really have a position. And like I said, we want interceptions out of our defensive backs. Not being around the ball, and I want interceptions.
I don't think you changed my tune. I was hard on Preppers, but I was listening to what you were saying. I went back to the lab and checked a lot of tape, and I do agree with you, because I think Preppers is, since he doesn't have a true position, he's like a project. And right now,
we don't need projects.
We don't need. This is what we don't need, Cowboy fans. We don't need injury prone. We don't need injury players that coming in the draft, they're already injured. We don't need players that are project that could project to something. We need players that can come in and start and play now. It's not 2 or 3 years, Cowboy fans. Now is the time. I'm tired of the waiting. I'm tired of the letdowns. I'm tired of these Cowboy haters saying, oh, y'all always choke. We have the team. We need the players on the defensive side to get where. I'm beating it in the head. I mean, we've been talking 2 hours. I've been talking all defense because that's what we need.
Yep. No more redshirt. And that's exactly what I was getting ready to say is, you know, we've hit on some of these picks, you know, with the Bruce Carters and the Jalen Smiths, where they've ended up playing pretty well for us. But I don't want to see – somebody mentioned Sidney Jones earlier. I don't remember exactly who it was.
Yeah,
man.
Somebody said
Sidney
third
Jones,
round.
I would love Sidney Jones in the third round. But I don't
– We don't have time to wait.
We don't know when he can come back. He's such a freak. And like I said, 2 years down the road, it would be great to have him on the team. But
we don't have 2 years.
We need him now.
Right. I think we got time to wait. The team is young.
I mean –
The team is young, but that, like I'm
but
saying
the
before,
windows,
the windows closing.
Not going to be there forever. I mean, you know how quickly this can change. I mean,
exactly.
We were 4-12 2 years ago.
Exactly. And so, it was just two injuries.
And that's all it was. So right now, without having Romo as a backup, we are one injury away from probably being 4-12 again.
Exactly.
Because we have your boy, Kellen Moore, back there.
Okay, I'll stay with that one. You're saying he's my boy. Okay, you're right. I did say it. I probably should change the tone.
No. You get your opinion. That's the good thing about this show.
I agree with what you're saying, though, because I'm not sold on a Kellen Moore as a backup.
Right.
I think we need a more veteran backup. And like you said, Kellen Moore is small. He's a little dude.
I just don't
He's
see
like
him 190 going out.
Pounds.
I don't see him going out and winning football games.
I
see him going out and playing football.
But
I don't see him winning a game. I don't see him winning more than two games for the Cowboys in a 16-game season.
I really don't.
And I
totally agree. We need to get a veteran backup. Even if we get a quarterback, they tried out some quarterbacks this year with the Dallas Cowboy Day. I don't want a rookie. We need a veteran, mm-hmm. and I think that's why everybody wanted Romo to stay, because we knew if we had Romo as a backup, we were straight.
Right.
Because Romo coming in is just going to come in and kill it. So I think that's what hurt everybody the most in my eyes, and hurt me the most.
I liked McCown from the Browns as much as he
– I like McCown, too.
He's a good ball player when he's healthy, and I think he's one of those players, if he can stay on our bench and he doesn't have to get hit, he can stay healthy. So.
I agree, McNeil. I don't see more. We're kind of all on agreement. We don't see Kellen Moore winning games for the Dallas Cowboys. So we can't hedge everything on Dak just because he's young, because guess what? He's one hit away. Everybody's one hit away from not playing ever again in the NFL. And it's that quick. Your career could be a 10-year career, or it could be a one game, ten season.
Luckily for us, I think we have Romo sitting on the bench. It's just wearing a CBS uniform, so we don't get him that game if something would happen. But I think the next one we have our quarterback, just in case anything does happen. It's not going to be Kellen Moore.
And tell him, and think about it. Don't you think Romo would relish coming back?
He thrived too.
I'm out the booth and just come back and throw touchdowns and win games. Who wouldn't love that?
Anybody got the Superman music on cue? That's just all I would hear. Yeah, I see him ripping off his CBS coat, like Superman ripping off his Clark Kent outfit, throwing on his cape, going out and saving the day.
I agree.
I hope we don't need to get there, gentlemen, but ladies and gentlemen. But man, I could see it. It gives me chills kind of thinking about it.
I mean, to me, it's all about healthy. We can all say everything we want, right? We can all talk about this, but it's all about health.
Yep.
I mean, we can say this till we're blue in the face. We have the team. But that's why I said you cannot waste opportunities in the NFL. They don't come around every year. I mean, let's look at the Patriots and even the Seahawks. Patriots lose players every year. They didn't have Gronk.
Big name.
One of their best players on the team, and they still won a Super Bowl.
They let players go like it's nothing.
Players go because they draft well.
Yep.
They don't overspend. They don't pay for players that if you're over 30 and you're not producing. Matter of fact, if you're 25 or 26 and maybe you got an attitude problem, or maybe we think we can't sign you to a long-term deal, we're trading you.
Yep.
And that's the smart thing. That's why they keep winning. Chandler Jones is not with them. They got rid of him. They still won
a
Super Bowl.
He's still a freak.
I mean, look at all the players they got rid of, and they still are winning Super Bowls.
Well, I think they realize the quarterback is the most valuable position on any team.
Yep.
I mean, I agree, but you got to. But also, here's the theory with them is they recycle players. They keep them players that are cheap. They don't spend a lot of money on you. And if you think you're going to get a lot of money and they don't think you're worth it, guess what? You're not getting that money from them.
Well, that's I'm talking about cap. I'm talking about money. Dustin wanted to talk about the cap relief we get from the Romo deal. So I'm pretty sure it was like 14 mil that we're going to save with him being a post June 1st. Cut.
But I think only $5 million is being allocated, because I think the rest is like 14 in cash. So I don't know if
bonuses,
it's
whatever.
Yeah, I don't know if it actually goes to money we can put in and use. But all the
it frees up some space. I don't think it's all $14 million, but it does help us. You know, if we need to put somebody
there,
we can.
I think that was the key for re-signing Zach Martin.
Yes, that does open up now. Next year, that's a big hit, because I think that opens up a lot of money for next year. And like you said, Zach Martin gets his big payday. And now
Zach Martin's going to get his payday this year. They're going to probably sign him before training camp.
Yeah, you're not letting him go through 2 weeks into the season without getting an extension, because Yeah, you don't want anything over his. You just want to let this man go out.
The same way they did with Travis Frederick last year, where Tyron Smith.
They just keep doing it.
They're extending them before training camp, so that they're
get
like,
it over with. Let him play.
Get over with. You got the contract. You got your money. We don't got to think about it. We don't have to worry about any kind of distraction. You're one of our core players, and Zach Martin deserves that money because Zach Martin is a freaking beast.
Yep.
He is. When we drafted him out of Notre Dame, I'm so glad that we didn't do the Johnny Manziel pick that
year.
Oh,
Lord. Yes.
Thank you, Stephen Jones. Once again, I give you salutes for not letting Jerry get Manziel. And we went, because I studied the tape on him, he was at Notre Dame. 4-year starter. First of all, 4-year starter at Notre Dame on the offensive line. I think you're going to be good. So
you get all 4 years?
4 years. I know you're coming in.
They put out some good offensive linemen.
He's a great player. So that I'm glad that he sees that.
John said we should get someone from the Patriots organization, like as far as a coach or something. I don't know if I agree with that because every time a New England coach has left, they haven't had any success wherever they've gone.
He's probably talking about like a GM or something, somebody in like the brain
that
trust.
Ain't happened.
We
don't even need to talk.
Yeah,
about that.
That's what I think he's talking about.
Stephen Jones is our GM now.
Yep, Stephen's taking over for Pops.
I think it's just in name with Jerry Jones now as GM, but Stephen Jones is making those decisions now. Jerry ain't making them decisions now. Mm-hmm. Not to me. Jerry is backing off now. To me, finally now. Jerry's always going to be in the news. Jerry's going to do what he's doing. But as far as making the moves, Willie Clay, Stephen Jones, those are our guys that are making the critical decisions. Willie Clay with getting our good draft picks and finding those gems. And Stephen Jones saying basically we're not overpaying for players anymore. We're not going to spend all this kind of money in free agency because we're not going to be in cap hell in the next 2 years if you guys aren't producing. Why spend that money on you and we don't know if you're even going to produce for us? Get somebody in the draft. Keep them young, and that way you're not killed in the cap. And when your core player comes up for a contract, you can go out and sign him like a Zach Martin because you're not killing yourself by signing 4 or 5 players with these astronomical contracts, and they're not producing. That's why it was cool to let Barry Church go. That's why it was cool to let Carr, Claiborne, and Wilcox all go. And Terrell McClain, Jack Edwards, all those guys, it was okay to let them go because you guys were just average with us. So why pay you this kind of money for average players? We don't need those. We have enough of those.
I like Dustin's question about Aaron Donald. We were big time into him in the draft.
We were going to draft him.
I thought he was coming.
We were going to draft him, but they got him. They got him before us. We were going to draft him.
That was going to happen. His contract year coming up, I don't even want to know what that number is going to be to try to sign him. I don't think we'll even have enough money to do it, honestly.
Yeah.
I would love to. I think he's too much
money.
He is the defensive tackle in the league. Yeah, I would love to have him.
Yeah, he's just too much money. Yeah. He's going to cost too much money. When his contract comes up, he's going to be the highest paid defensive tackle in the
game.
He's getting paid. So as much as I would love to get him, I loved him before the draft. And the Cowboys were talking about getting Aaron Donald before the draft. Like, he was the one that we were going to draft.
Yeah.
But they drafted him right before us. We end up taking somebody else, but he's going to get a lot of money, point blank, and we just aren't going to be able to afford him. No. But Will Jones, I was listening to you. Stephen Jones, like I said, I'm a Stephen Jones lover. I love how he's like, we're not going to overpay for players. We're going to keep on building through the draft. We're going to stay young. We're not going to keep these old players. If you're 32, I mean, think about it. When we had Jason Hatcher, he just came off that 11-sack season. One of the best seasons as a defensive tackle, 11 sacks, but guess what? He was 33.
Let him go. Where'd he go? Redskins and do
he did nothing.
Bunk. Nothing.
He went to the Redskins. And honestly, DeMarcus Ware leaving, I was glad Ware left because I wanted him to get a Super Bowl.
I'm glad he left, but I know what you're saying.
Yeah. Like, if he's not going to win with
financially.
Us, if he's not going to win with us, let him go to a team that he can possibly get a Super Bowl because he deserves that.
Yep.
But even at the end of the day, he wasn't disruptive without Von Miller.
Right. It made him that much better.
It made him better.
He had a nice impact on Von Miller and, you know, Danny Trevathan and Brandon Williams, or Brandon Marshall. He had an impact on those linebackers over there for sure.
Hey, and shout out to Dustin Merriman. We appreciate the thanks for doing this. Hey, we appreciate you. Thanks for tuning in. We love the questions. We love talking to you guys about Cowboys football.
Yeah. Make sure to check us out every Sunday about 1:30.
Every Sunday. It's going down. And Dustin, don't forget. Check us out. Like I said, all Cowboys fans, don't forget to check us out in the next couple weeks. The draft will be here the next few weeks. We are going to have a draft board. We're going to put a draft board together. So specifically, we're going to talk about gems, hidden players, who we think maybe get drafted. So make sure you're chiming in on that so we can hear what you
get. Your draft boards prepared.
Get your
also,
draft boards prepared.
A lot of you guys looking on the page, you might see a bunch of those highlights. If you have any players you want to see, let us know because – I'm fishing for highlights every day, all day.
Yep. So let exactly. me know. If you guys got some nice links you want to share, you know, get on the Facebook Silver Blue Nation. Show us some articles you guys like. Show us some videos, and you know, let's converse a little bit, gentlemen.
The website is up and coming. I mean, it's under maintenance right now, but stay tuned for a lot of new, cool, fan interactive type content on that page too, as well as highlights.
Ryan Dodd, like you said, you're hearing us. All right, Merriman, Dory Jackson, love him. I think we need to take him. USC. Good pick. I like him as a corner, and he's a good return specialist, because I think we do need a return specialist because Lucky Whitehead still has not stepped up. And it doesn't seem like Lucky Whitehead, whenever he gets a big run, he fumbles.
Yeah.
Every time he gets tackled hard, he fumbles. So
Beasley was scaring me with that for a little bit, too. Beasley, he's always trying for extra yards.
No, I think Beasley don't want to be back there.
I'm not talking about on punts. I'm talking about just when he touches the ball in general. He kind of scares me a little bit.
He does seem to. Dez does it too.
And I was going to say,
Dez is always getting hurt fighting for extra yards.
I didn't mean to completely skip over the question earlier about that. Somebody asked about why wasn't Dez returning punts. Because
he's always getting hurt. He's always fighting for the extra
yards. I don't want
him doing it. I mean, think about it. You guys watched the Chicago game. When Dez is always – I mean, Cowboys fans, we all talk about it. You, JK, we all talk about it. When Dez gets the ball, we're all like, go down, go down, go down, Dez, because we're worried about him getting turned down wrong and then him twisting the knee and him out being 4 weeks. Just go down, Dez. We understand that you're fighting for the yards. Go down,
I just want to throw this out there. Probably a lot of people consider the top receiver in the league, Antonio Brown, returns punts for Pittsburgh.
But he's not injury prone like Dez.
He's a beast.
That's what I think.
Good chime in, G. I like that.
I like that. He threw the curveball.
I know. I was like,
it was like,
I didn't even think about that, man.
Strike three and you're out.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. No, you stunned me, man.
Strike three, you're out.
That was good.
Oh,
he's overrated.
Beck, I totally agree with you. Why did we get rid of Dwayne Harris? I totally agree with you, Beck.
He wanted too much money.
Yes. He did want some money. He got, 4 years, $17 million?
He got paid, man. Yeah, I'm only mad at him because he went to the Giants. I mean, come on. But he's all right.
Go somewhere else.
No, he wasn't that great.
Yes, he did. He returned that big touchdown against us when we were.
Yeah, he did do that. Was that week one?
No, that was when Greg Hardy, when we came back with Matt Kessel, and we had that bust from Pittsburgh. What's his name? Receiver.
Devin Street bust.
But anyway,
he was a fourth round pick.
He was a bust.
He still is scrub.
Terrible. But Matt Castle threw that rope play. I don't know how he caught that touchdown. We tied the game up, and then I'm like, I was like, please don't kick it, Dwayne Harris. I just feel like he's going to run this back, and boom, runs it back, touchdown, they win the game. Man. Feelings hurt. I hate it.
How about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys? But Dwayne Harris was definitely a big loss, because not only was he a good returner, he was thick. Yeah. He had a big body, so he could take those hits. And he hit a lot of people when he was on the other side of the ball. He put the wood on a lot of people, so I like him. Hey, Davis, I hear what you're saying. Kevin King, Washington, I like that. That's a good size.
Yep.
6'3", 200. I'm going to check him out. Like I said, I'm going to go deep in my
draft.
Deep
on these guys.
I'm getting my Pro Football Weekly draft book, and I'm going to go deep. But I like that size, 6'3", 200. You don't got to be a 4'4 guy, because we play a lot of coverage.
Yep.
We will play press man, but that's when we need those guys to get off the quarterback. And to me, Ron Marinelli needs to still throw timely blitzes, because when he did throw those blitzes at the end of the year, we were so much better when we blitzed at times.
Back to getting the pressure. I mean, if you're sitting back in cover two, you're not bringing heat. We need to bring pressure, get in the quarterback's head, rattle him around a little bit. Let our defensive backs make plays, please.
And far as Darrell Revis, no. I don't think we go after him, because he's going to want too much money.
No.
I think he still feels like he's still top-tier cornerback, so he's going to want that money. And Stephen Jones has already said he's not overpaying for anybody, and especially not overpaying for somebody who's over 30 years old and on the downside of his career.
Nope.
He's not going to do that, so I don't see
Darrell
Revis with
us. Much rather Richard Sherman than Revis at this point.
Yeah, I don't see him coming at all. And if you look at what we've been rehashing all day, it looks like a lot of the fans have been talking like we've been talking. Rico Gathers has been a name that's been –
it's been popping up.
Been popping up everywhere.
Not bad for somebody that hasn't played football since
high
school.
He hasn't played football since high school.
He's going to be a freak. John, he's going to be a freak. I think he's got – I don't think Witten's going to play all 4 years of that new contract.
No,
but
I don't either.
He's got 2 to 3 good years of learning under Jason Witten, how to block as a tight end, how to catch, how to run the route tree. and how to, I mean, he already knows how to box out in the red zone. This dude's going to be probably a monster for us.
I think so, too. And you know who's an unknown player for us that really helped our offense that nobody talks about? Keith Smith at fullback. If y'all don't remember, Keith Smith has gone back and forth playing linebacker. They couldn't find a position for him.
So they ended up getting rid of Rod Smith.
Yeah, Rod Smith and Keith Smith. But they cut him a couple times because we couldn't find a position. We finally moved him to full-time fullback, and he has shined. He has shined with Zeke in that backfield, and he's one of the reasons why he got those yards as well. Yep. He's been laying the wood. He's an unsung player with us. Keith Smith converting from linebacker to fullback, and I like him back in the fold.
Jacob Pedroza, what's up, man? How about them Cowboys?
So we drafted that Cowboys
corner. Are you saying we should go after the corner from Ohio State? I think Gerrion Conley, yes. I don't think Hooker is going to be around. And, yes, Rod Smith is Jalen Smith's brother. He's also Zeke's roommate at Ohio State for a brief time. And I think they were roommates together last year in Dallas until Rod got cut.
And I think he might always have a position. I think Dallas will always kind of go back to him. So, like, if we ever need him in the fold.
Just call Jalen's brother real quick.
Just call Rod Smith. I think he'll always come back to the
Cowboys.
He's going
to be Jalen's brother. You don't call him Rod anymore. Okay, you call Jalen's brother.
He's
Jalen's brother.
Yeah. But,
yes, he will be a beast.
I do like I was agreeing with you with Gerrion Conley. Ohio State puts out very good corners, and he's got good size. He's about 6'1".
He's around the ball a lot.
He's around the ball. He can play press coverage. Yes, I love to see him. If Gerrion Conley slips to us in 28th, and they're really not sure about somebody on the defensive end, take him. I agree with you. I didn't agree with you at first because I was on Peppers, but I agree. Conley will be phenomenal.
I know that's a good corner. Drafting a lot of Big Ten, like we said earlier, and dipping in the Ohio State. Well, it feels like a homer pick for me, but you know, I really like Gerrion Conley, and I think that he made Malik Hooker look even better than he really might have been. They complement each other very well. I guess I shouldn't say made him look better because Hooker's going to be a beast too.
Okay.
I would like to get him, Gerrion Conley.
Lattimore's going to be good too.
He's going to be a beast. Yeah. But I think Conley is better than Lattimore personally.
Yeah.
They don't have him rated as high, but I think he's better.
I like Conley. I think Conley is better than Lattimore too. Yep.
Without the injury concerns too.
Exactly. I've seen that. So, I do want to answer a question right here from Zachary Buchanan. What's up, Mr. Buchanan? Jalen Smith's leg. They were saying that the knee was regenerating. It's a slow process. He still does have drop foot. So he basically is still wearing the brace on his foot. So his foot is basically still dropping. So whenever he walks, the foot drops when he walks. So that's why they have the brace. But, I mean, I don't know how somebody can come back.
I don't think he's going to be 100.
Because he's saying that he's running 4-5, and you've seen the highlights. I mean, you've seen the tape on him. He looks ridiculous. But training and playing football is two totally different things.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm still worried about that knee. It still scares me.
I think he's coming back. I just don't know if it's going to be 100% because that's a tough injury to be about 100% from. But if we get him at 90 to 95%, then that's a steal in the second round. Even sitting out a year with a red shirt, that's good for me.
Okay, Dustin, I'm hearing what you're saying. Like I said, Mixon.
If he's there, man.
If he's there in the third round, I'm almost tempted to take him.
Yeah.
He is good.
He is good.
If him and Zeke are back there,
that's when you start seeing if somebody will trade that bag of balls for Alfred Morris. And, and then you can start dangling McFadden
And think about it. And then you can dangle McFadden. And then if you keep Mixing in the fold, he's good trade bait for later on down the line. You get capital for him. I love Joe Mixon. I've been screaming Joe Mixon from day one.
Kind of with you, John. Don't touch Mixon. I just don't want any more of that, though. I mean, like, I don't mind the idea of him being there, but I just don't want the issues. I don't need any more. We have enough bad press coming out of the running back position with, you know, domestic issues as is.
I see that side of the story, but if he's there, I'm taking him. I'm sorry.
I remember Mary's, John. I remember Joseph Randall.
Let's look at it. Look at Bill Belichick. Is he taking – they're winning Super Bowls, but is he taking players that are the cleanest players? Look at Michael Floyd. He just got cut from the air. Hold up.
He didn't even get a ring.
It doesn't matter, but he picked him up, though, after getting the DUI. He didn't have a DUI. He had extreme DUI.
Yes, I saw the video. He was asleep at the wheel at the red light.
And they still picked him up. So as much as character is, and I see it because it all comes back to Randy Gregory. I think it all comes back to Randy Gregory because we're so upset about him not playing and being on the field because of his troubles. And even me saying Randy Gregory right now hurts my heart. Yeah. Hurts because to me, and I will say it again, Cowboys fans, he is the player.
Yep.
He's
Roger,
the player.
Sorry to hear about your leg, man. That sucks. Hopefully Jalen can get some expert medical attention and it doesn't happen.
Someone asked, Jacob and Lisa asked if RG3 is a legit option for backup quarterback.
Nope.
No.
Nope. I Colin Kaepernick. If we're going to talk about picking up a quarterback like that, Kaepernick.
Yeah, I take Kaepernick over RG3 all day. He's done. And me and you, G, we were up there at the Browns inner squad scrimmage, and what was the first thing we said? He's little.
He's little.
Yeah, he did look a lot smaller in person than what you see on TV.
Like, the kid, the dude is small. Like, he's not big at all. And he takes one hit, and it's like he's the weirdest guy as far as taking a hit. Like, normal people get hit certain ways, but he gets hit, like, the wrong ways.
He doesn't know how to
– like, you don't know how to slide. It's like you awkward.
Like, that was – you know, it was slick, like Roy Jones and Bernard Hopkins. They knew how to take a punch. They knew how to roll with a punch.
Exactly.
He does not know how to take a punch.
Exactly.
You hit him, he leans the wrong way, and it knocks him out even harder.
I agree.
He about breaks his neck. So
And even look at Dak. When Dak slid, he slid perfectly. He did it like a baseball player. Like, he already had to slide down.
Yeah.
I mean, I love the way Dak does it, on my opinion.
Ryan says no to Kaepernick, and I don't think he already said he's not going to be doing the kneeling stuff
this year. I don't
think he's
going to do that, especially when he comes with Dallas. If he comes with Dallas, he's not going to do that.
Jerry already told him he nobody's kneeling on
his
team.
Nobody's kneeling on Dallas.
You know, Kaepernick, what he was doing wasn't all that bad. What he was trying to raise awareness for something he was truly passionate about.
He's not going to be a
problem
in the
locker room.
I don't
mind that from anybody. The dude put up numbers still. That's the biggest thing. He's still a productive quarterback with a live arm. And we don't have a backup quarterback right now.
And don't you want someone similar to the skill set that you have with that?
Yes, he can come right in. Gee, that's perfect. Especially Kaepernick's skill set fits perfect with our offense.
Right.
Because you don't fall off because, just like you said, if you go from Dak to Kellen Moore, we have to change our whole offense.
Right.
Because Kellen Moore can't scramble.
Thanks for the comment, Ryan.
So we can't go like that. So to get a Kaepernick, you don't have to worry about switching the offense. He can slide right in. And you don't think Kaepernick is going to be better playing with Zeke, our offensive line, Dez Bryant. He didn't have anybody. He still played decent with San Francisco.
Right.
When he had players, he went to the Super Bowl.
Even if they say garbage time, whatever, those are still NFL numbers. They don't have garbage time asterisks next to him. So
exactly.
He still has the same
touchdowns and still four picks.
If you guys got access to your computers and stuff, look up Tyrod Taylor's stats compared to Colin Kaepernick's stats last year. And they are almost identical. And look at the two different positions they're in right now, where Tyrod Taylor is going to be a $9 million a year starter. Kaepernick can't get sniffed at by a team. So it's unfair to him. And
yes,
I think we might be able to get him for cheap. Let's do it.
And I don't know why we're not. Like, he is out there on the market. Why is Dallas Cowboys not getting Kaepernick? Like I said, if you really think about it, when was Kaepernick really a problem? He was voted by his team as one of the most popular players by his teammates.
Right.
He was voted
by the
players.
While
all that stuff was going on. So if the players are not saying that about him, so why is everybody else judging him because he took a knee? I understand why people are saying that, but he was not a cancer in the locker room. He was not a cancer on the field. And when he got on the field, players rallied around him. And when he had the players, he's shown in that little bit of a run, he can take you to playoff games. He can win playoff games. And if it wasn't for maybe one play in that Super Bowl, they win.
Right.
They marched all the way down the field, and he overthrew the pass for the touchdown. If he catches the pass, Michael Crabtree, in that end zone, that's a touchdown. San Francisco wins. He has a Super Bowl. And then we're talking something different.
Yep. And to that point, you know, we've got people I've seen on some of these Cowboys pages around here. There's people asking if we should re-sign Greg Hardy. But then they're saying yes, but they wouldn't re-sign Kaepernick.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. That's two different stories.
It just doesn't make sense.
That's domestic violence.
You know, exactly. And Colin Kaepernick was standing up for something he really, truly believed in.
Nobody
and it wasn't like
up
it was
for
something.
Domestic violence.
Right. And we're okay with taking a Greg Hardy back. We gave him a chance a couple years ago. You guys wouldn't give Kaepernick a chance?
Exactly.
And at least the press that Kaepernick was generating was for a good cause, and it actually probably raised some awareness for his. For his cause.
And guess what?
You know?
And he's been doing a lot of stuff in the community. He's been donating his money. So I'm not bashing Colin Kaepernick. We need to sign him. If we can sign him, sign him. Because I feel a lot better with him as a backup than Kellen Moore. And I'm listening to you, Buchanan. Brandon Gregory is like what you're talking about, Randy Gregory. Mm-hmm. He is the next Charles. Dude, we don't know as far as because he's been out of the game, but he is the next great. I don't care what anybody says. I will stand with this. Just like reason why – what do you think the reason why the Cleveland Browns are not getting rid of Josh Gordon?
Because they know we're going to swoop him up.
Because
they do.
how long he's been in trouble for. He hasn't played in 3 years.
Yep.
But guess what? As soon as the Cleveland Browns cut him, somebody is picking him up.
And his name's going to be Jerry Jones.
Yes.
It's going to be Jerry Jones.
Jerry Jones is going to – if he gets cut, Jerry Jones is taking Josh Gordon. I don't care what anybody says.
Yep.
He's getting Josh Gordon.
And I'd be okay with giving Josh Gordon a shot. It's just weed, not beating on your spouse or something like that. It's something that's a little bit more – admissible. You know, you can kind of let it slide just because it's, you know, obviously it's hurting his team, but that's something that really just hurts himself.
And
but,
I'm listening to Dustin, and I totally agree with you.
That's spot on, Dustin.
Quietly, he didn't burn anything. He did it in his own way. And
talking about Kaepernick.
Yes, yeah. And just to get, yep. I totally agree with you, Dustin, on that. He did it the right way. He didn't go,
you know, smashing bricks through windows and stuff like that. He stood up for it, and it was a, like you said, small one. You may not have agreed with it, but
we all do something.
You got what he was trying to say. You know what he was talking about.
He brought the awareness.
Right.
That's
whether
what
or not
his
you,
purpose.
You now know what he was kneeling for, whether or not you like it or not. So it kind of worked, you know.
And John McNeil, we're all on the same board with Randy Gregory.
Yeah.
That's why I agree with you. That's why they gave him 94, because they knew when he came in, they knew he is that good. He is that player, so you're getting 94. That's why he got the number, because we all know he's that good. It's only been the off-field issues. And I, for one, I'm sorry that he's making these mistakes, but I, for one, am like Jerry Jones. He said he's a baby. He's an ugly baby. He said he's an ugly baby right now.
One line about that. Either.
But guess what? He ain't getting rid of him, and we ain't getting rid of him, because that dude has got too much talent. Do not let go of Randy Gregory. Why? Why would you let him go? Just let him be in the fold. Keep drafting your players. And then when he comes back, he's still only 24 years old.
We still have him. So.
And think about it. It's not like he's the only person smoking marijuana in the NFL.
And I would look much rather.
Look how many people are getting popped. And if anybody's going to do any kind of thing crazy, I'm not condoning. I'm just saying, if anything's going to do anything crazy, marijuana to me is one of the least things as far as alcohol or anything related incidents.
I would much rather see the players be able to medicate themselves with marijuana than, you know, just strictly painkillers and injections and stuff like that they're, you know, getting addicted to and having all sorts of other side effects from. So I think it's healthier in the long run for that. But that's a different topic, different discussion. How about them Cowboys? Maybe next week we can talk about that.
Definitely. And Buchanan, you've been giving some nice good questions, and I like that. He says, does he think the younger Watts will translate from a 3-4 to a 4-3? I definitely will, because he's athletic.
I think it's just in the blood.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard not to.
You just see certain players that have those genes that are just going to be good. And I think you put Watts in a 3-4, a 4-3, just like if you put JJ in a 4-3 or a 3-4, the dude is just so good, he's just going to translate. And any kind of scheme you put him in, he's just too good.
He's a football player.
He's a football
player.
People
play football no matter where you put him, I think.
And
so,
if we can
question.
Get Watts,
I like that last name.
I don't mind TJ Watts with us.
You know, we said the younger brother is always
the
better.
They're always more feisty. And to me, if you're blending those guys with Jalen Smith, but look what Sean Lee did. I mean, he's finally been healthy. Shout outs to Sean Lee, because we've been waiting forever for him to stay healthy.
Yep.
The last couple of years, he's been relatively healthy, especially last year. Look what he did. Sean Lee, did you watch that New York Giants game in New York where he had like 20 tackles? He was a beast. He reads the plays. If we get those guys that can fill around him, we need the war daddies, like Jerry Jones says. As we are almost done here with our Q&A today, we're kind of
probably about to wrap it up here soon. We'll probably take a couple more. I gotta go get my little youngster here in a minute.
And I gotta see my son. You know,
I gotta do the family thing a little bit.
Let me give a shout out right now to my son Jamon Yates, because I beat you in Mortal Kombat. I had to tell you, because you were beating me really bad. You beat me 11 straight when you had the game yesterday.
Uh-oh.
You beat me 11 straight, but guess what? I beat you 20 straight today. He said, oh, that made your day? And I said, yes, it did, because you're whooping me in all the other
games. There you go, JJ.
And
you got to step your game up.
Step your game up, big step dog, because I'll be home today to bust you up some more.
I know you're all tall and stuff now, but you still got to get with control.
How about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys?
But I won't play Madden 17 against them, because he will
smash
me.
You don't want that.
But I'm playing with them Cowboys, and I don't know about you. If Cowboy fans out there, if you ever play Madden, did you play with the Cowboys, or did you play with somebody else? Because when they made us good, it's kind of like, I don't want to play with the Cowboys because everybody's going to play with them.
I always play with somebody else because the haters are out there.
You're playing with them because the Cowboys now. Yeah. I'm like, no,
I
I'm a deep
use
Cowboys.
Dallas.
You know what I'm saying? It's, you're just playing with them now because they're good.
They're just the best team, so you got to play with somebody else.
Exactly.
And I'll beat you with the Browns.
Exactly. So, hey, we're getting ready to wrap it up here.
Yep.
Another great Q&A.
Appreciate everybody.
Thank you, everybody, for showing up.
Appreciate everybody that tuned in. Freaking awesome.
Yeah.
I think it's just awesome.
It's awesome.
Cowboy fans everywhere.
Every Sunday from now
Every
on.
Sunday, check us out. Don't forget to check us out next 2 weeks. Cowboys fans, next 2 weeks, we will have the draft board right here.
We're going live.
We'll have the draft board. We'll have our players who will think who the Cowboys should pick or maybe pick. You guys, make sure you guys chime in with us.
Do a little bit of research with us. Let us know what you think.
Do some research on your own. We'll do some research on ours. I know I am. I'm going to be deep in the book. I'm going to be checking out the videotape, checking out the
players. It's a Silver&blue nation out there.
Silver&blue nation. So we'll be here. So we can't – we next 2 weeks is going to be super exciting because we'll be able to finally see who our Cowboys are going to draft.
Yep.
We'll be able to talk about the players. There's nothing better than that. And it's all about the Cowboys.
Yep.
It's
all about
Let's hear this little word from Michael Irvin before we get out of here.
You love them or you hate them, but you will tune in and turn in to see what people are saying about them. That's why they call America's team.
Ooh.
Doesn't that get you hype? We appreciate you, Dustin, Mr. McNeil, Ryan Dye, everybody. Like I said, if I didn't get everybody's name on here, we appreciate all y'all. Annette, what's up? That's my homegirl. What's up?
What's up?
But, you know,
tuned for more. It's getting bigger and better.
Getting bigger and better. And make sure, like I said, we're going to have videos this week. The weekly update.
Weekly
we'll be
updates.
Here. JK is going to have his weekly update. I'll have it's going to be hype. We're going to be getting exciting. So, all you Cowboy fans, don't forget to tune in. Silver and Blue Nation. Follow us on Twitter, SBNation17.
That's it.
Website.
Get that Instagram, SilverBlueNation, SilverBlueNation.com. You know where to get us on Facebook.
He's got blogs coming.
You got YouTube. Get on that YouTube. We got a channel there. That's where you get the notifications for those weekly updates.
Exactly.
The website's fantastic. G has put that thing together. It's smooth like butter, and it's just getting better.
It's exactly getting better. So, hey. All right, one last time.
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah, one more time. How about them Cowboys?
Say it with
us now. How about them Cowboys? Yeah!
All right, so
don't forget, Q&A next week, same bat time, same bat channel. How about them Cowboys for Big Game James?
JK.
Producer G.
We'll see you next week. Cowboys, peace.
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah! You love them or you hate them, but you will tune in and turn in to see what people are saying about them. That's why they call America's team.